a service of KIBMRadio.com, the Internet's home for an all-old-time radio.
In just a moment, X-1. But first, how does one man get himself into so many impossible situations? Well, this is a question you'll probably ask yourself tomorrow night when you follow another hilarious misadventure of Throckmorton P. Gildersleeve. Yes, Gildy's eye for the ladies and his impulsive temperament managed to entangle him in a web of riotous circumstances. Be sure to join the romantic water commissioner, his neighbors, Judge Hooker, Mr. Peavy, and all the loyal Gildersleeve household as they romp through another episode of The Great Gildersleeve tomorrow night. And now stay tuned for X-1 on NBC.
X-1 salutes our Philadelphia station. Its new call letters, WRCV.
Countdown for blast off. X-5, 4, 3, 2, X-1, fire.
From the far horizons of the unknown come transcribed tales of new dimensions in time and space. These are stories of a future, adventures in which you'll live in a million could-be years on a thousand maybe worlds. The National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, presents
X-1.
Tonight's story, Skulking Permit, by Robert Sheckley.
August 16th, year 2204. 2, Central Colonial Administrative Authority, Alpha Centauri Sector. From Colonial Contact Inspector 37. Subject, Planet New Delaware. Following the procedure outlined in manual for contact with lost colonies, open communication by interstellar radio with New Delaware. This is the first contact established in 200 years. And proceeding on overdrive for personal investigation, situation on New Delaware appears unconventional, to say the least.
Hi there. Hi, Billy.
Hi, Tom. Got no time for talking this morning. Got to get this sign up.
It's a real pretty sign. No aliens allowed within city limits. What's an alien?
Beats me. The mayor told me to put it up. He says to me, Billy Painter, you're chief of police, so I want you to paint me a big sign and set it right in front of the town hall.
Aliens. Oh, it's a real pretty word.
Billy Painter, I thought I told you.
Take it easy, Mayor. I put the sign up.
It's not that, it's the church.
I painted it just like you told me.
I know, but you painted it wrong.
I painted that church with a nice bright red. What's wrong with that?
I looked it up. It's a little red schoolhouse, not church house. Churches are supposed to be white.
Can't keep track of them all. Schoolhouse, church house, jail, post office. Got along fine enough in New Delaware for 200 years without them.
I know, but we need them now, and we haven't got much time. Where are the carpenter boys?
I saw Sam and Marv over at Ed Beer's Tavern.
Well, Billy, you go down there and tell them that they've got to build us a little schoolhouse, and you paint it red. It's very important.
Mayor, when do I get a police chief badge? I read that a police chief always gets a badge.
Make yourself one. Now go on.
All right, then.
Oh, it sure is hot here. I don't know why the inspector couldn't have come in winter. Oh, Tom Fisher.
Yeah?
Tom, I've got a job for you, a very important job.
Well, now, look, Mayor, I'm on vacation. Fish won't be back in these waters.
No vacation, not now. He's due any day. Tom, how would you like to be a criminal?
I don't know. What's a criminal?
Well, come over to my house and I'll explain. I've got to appoint a criminal, and it looks to me like you're it.
Mm-hmm.
You don't mind sitting right next to the interstellar radio, do you? I'm waiting for a call.
Thought that thing was broken.
No, it wasn't broken. My father told me always to leave the monitor on recording in case. Just didn't seem to be anybody calling, not for 200 years. Not since that war back on Earth. It's time now. You just listen, Tom. They said that they would call just at this time.
New Delaware, do you hear me? New Delaware, come in immediately.
Yes, we hear you. He's very touchy.
This is Colonial Inspector 37. As I told you in my broadcast yesterday, there's been no contact with the other colonies for some centuries due to unsettled conditions here. But that's over, except for a little mopping up. Now, New Delaware is still a colony of Earth and subject to her laws. Do you acknowledge that status?
Oh, yes. We called a town meeting last night and talked it all over. We're still loyal to Earth.
Excellent. That saves us the trouble of sending an expeditionary force to reconquer you. However, as Colonial Contact Inspector, I will be obliged to make a personal investigation to make sure that you conform fully to the customs, institutions, and traditions of Imperial Earth.
Imperial? That's funny. All the books talk about Earth as a united democracy.
Well, a lot can change in 200 years. And, of course, there's been a war.
Do you hear me, New Delaware?
Oh, yes. Yes, sir. We hear you.
You realize, of course, there is room for only one intelligent species in the universe. Man. All others must be suppressed, wiped out. We can tolerate no aliens. I'm sure you understand, General.
I'm not a general. I'm a mayor.
You're in charge, aren't you?
Yes.
Then you're a general. I'll be sure you're running an Earth colony, General, with no radical departures from the norm, such as free will, free speech, free elections, or anything else on the proscribed list. It is impossible to administer an empire where everyone does as he pleases. Get your colony in order, General. I will call to inspect you in exactly 1 week. That is all.
Well, you see how it is, Tom. Now, Tom, about your job, I'm appointing you town criminal.
I don't see why there has to be a criminal.
That's a very important part of Earth society. All the books say so, Tom. The criminal is as important as the postman or the police chief. He works against society. If you don't have people working against society, how can you have people working for it? How can there be any more important job?
Well, I don't want to do it.
Now, be reasonable, Tom. Put yourself in my position. This inspector comes and he meets Billy Painter, our police chief. He asks to see the jail. Then he says, no prisoners? How can I hold my head up and tell him that we don't have any crime? No crime, you'll say. But Earth colonies always have crime. Don't you see that, Tom? Right there, the whole thing falls through. He'll see that we're not truly Earth-like. We're faking it. We're aliens. And you heard what he said about being rough on aliens.
Well, yeah, but why me?
Can't spare anyone else. And you've got narrow eyes. Criminals always have narrow eyes.
Well, they aren't that narrow.
Tom, please, we're all doing our part. You want to help now, don't you?
Oh, I suppose so.
Fine! You're our criminal. Here, I've got this paper all made out for you, just to make it legal.
Skulking permit.
Know all men by these presents that Tom Fisher is a duly authorized thief and murderer. He is hereby required to skulk in dismal alleys, haunt places of low repute, and to break the law.
Yeah, what's the law?
I'll let you know as fast as I make them up. All Earth colonies have laws.
Oh, well, what do I do?
You steal and kill. Look, I'll give you a couple of books on it. Steal as much as you like. One murder should be enough. Don't overdo it.
It don't sound sensible somehow.
Well, you can work up to it, Tom. Why don't you start off easy, like by haunting a place of low repute?
Hello, Tom. I hear you're our official criminal now.
That's right. I have a beer.
How's it going?
Well, I've been studying. I can't put my finger on it yet.
Hey, did you get the weapons Mary Carpenter sent over?
Yeah, a hatchet, a spear, two knives, and a blackjack.
Uh-huh.
I stuck myself with a spear, Ed. The whole thing ain't sensible to me. I can't figure out what's the purpose of crime. What do people get out of it?
Here's the beer. I tried a new route this time. Tell me how you like it.
Very dry. Less filling.
How come you ain't out thieving now, Tom?
Oh, I'm planning. My permit says I have to haunt places of low repute, and that's why I'm here.
Well, this ain't no place of low repute.
You serve the worst meals in town.
I know. My wife can't cook. But there's a real friendly atmosphere here. The folks like it, Tom.
It's all changed, Ed. I'm making this tavern my headquarters. It's now a criminal lair.
Try to keep a nice place and a lot of thanks, Sheegan.
Hi, Tom. You steal anything yet?
Oh, well, not yet, Mary, no.
I'll have a paracula, Ed. Don't worry, Tom. You'll catch on. If anyone in this village can learn, you can.
Sure, we got confidence in you, Tom.
Why don't you steal something right now, Tom? Go ahead.
Well, suppose I could.
I brought some geefers in my basket. They're real ripe. You could steal those.
Well, they are nice-looking geefers, Mary. Real tasty.
Go ahead, Tom. Steal it.
Well, I... These are nice-looking geefers. Mind if I take one out of the light and look at it?
No, Tom, you go right ahead.
Now, just a minute there.
Hi, Billy, what do you have?
I'm on official police business. What were you doing with that geefer, Tom?
Just looking at it.
I don't think you were just looking at it, Tom. I think you were planning on stealing it. You're a suspicious character. I think I better lock you up for further questioning.
No, Billy. What are you doing?
I'm doing my duty, Mayor. Tom here is looking mighty suspicious. The book says...
I know what the book says. I gave you the book. You can't go arresting Tom, not yet.
But there's no other criminal in the village.
Oh, Billy, don't you understand? This village needs a criminal record. Acting suspiciously isn't a crime.
All right, but I was just trying to do my job. I'll still get you, Tom. Remember, crime does not pay.
Hey, that's a real slick way of putting it, isn't it?
I thought it was kind of catchy. I read it in a book.
Well, Tom, go ahead now. Steal something.
Well, I'm not in the mood anymore.
You better get to it soon, and don't forget the murder.
Is it really necessary?
Oh, I wish it weren't, but this colony has been here for over 200 years, and we haven't had a single murder. Not one.
Well, I suppose we should have one. No, I'll take care of it.
Good boy, Tom. We're counting on you. Billy! I want you to paint up a couple hundred signs saying private property, no trespassing, violators will be prosecuted, and a dozen saying speed limit 35 miles an hour.
Why? All we got is those quag horses, and they won't go faster than a walk.
Never mind, you got to have a speed limit. It's civilized. Well, that's the last of the signs, Billy. You might as well get some sleep.
Aren't you going home, Mayor?
No, I've got to get out to Fred Farmer's. I appointed him postmaster since nobody ever sends letters around here. I promised to help him write all those letters.
Well, good night, Mayor. I guess I better be making my rounds.
Good night, Billy.
Who's that? Tom? Tom Fisher? You out thieving? Who's there? Don't move or I'll shoot. Hey, Tom, come back.
What's going on out there? What's all the racket?
It's the town criminal, Ed. I think I heard him robbing your house.
Yeah?
He's made his getaway now. But don't you worry. I'll get him yet.
All right, but get him in the morning, will you? Some of us are trying to sleep.
Morning, Marv. How's the schoolhouse coming?
Fair. Would have come along better if I had my saw.
Your saw?
Yeah. I left it leaning against my door last night. Wasn't there this morning, Tom.
Oh, yeah, your saw. Well, you know how it is, Marv. I had to practice some skulking last night.
Yeah, sure. Say, do you suppose I could use the saw for a while, just for an hour or two?
Well, I don't know. It's legally stolen, you know.
Well, I'd give it back. I wouldn't keep anything that was legally stolen.
Well, it's in the house with the rest of the loot.
Okay, I'll go borrow it then.
Tom, I've been looking for you.
Morning, Mayor.
Did you steal my bronze plaque?
I certainly did.
Oh, well, I was just wondering. You did it just in time. You see up there?
What?
Up there, the black dot near the rim of the sun.
Oh, what is it?
Well, I'll bet it's the inspector's ship. You got your murder planned? Time is running short, Tom. The inspector may land any hour now. That darn radio's been yapping at me something about a revolt at Deng Four, and all Earth colonies are to prepare for conscription, whatever that is. So let's get that killing over with.
I don't know, though. Murder...
Now, look, Tom. Criminals on Earth commit dozens of murders a day and think nothing of it. All this village wants of you is one little killing. Is that too much to ask? Now, who will it be, Tom?
I guess I'll kill George Waterman.
Why?
Why?
Why not?
What's your motive?
I thought you just wanted a murder. Who said anything about a motive?
We can't have a fake murder. On Earth, every murderer has a motive.
Well, I don't like the way George walks, never did, and he's noisy.
No. That might be good enough for a crime of passion, but you're a legal criminal. Tom, you're ruthless, cold-blooded, and cunning. You can't kill someone just because you don't like the way he walks. That's silly.
I better think the whole thing over.
Well, don't take too long. Oh, and Tom, don't forget to leave clues. They're very important.
Have another beer, Tom.
I don't mind if I do.
Hey, how do you like the way I fixed the tavern over? I hung up dirty curtains, you know. Oh. That makes it a dismal retreat. Because I figured if this was going to be your headquarters, it ought to be a real criminal's lair. How do you like the bloodstains on the floor?
That's only Billy Painter's root-berry red paint.
Oh, I know, but it looks like bloodstains. Hey, how's the murder coming?
Oh, not so good. I've been thinking about it, Ed. Do you realize I'm supposed to kill somebody? I'm supposed to make somebody cease to exist. I mean, like, take Marv Carpenter. Here he is today working on his schoolhouse, big fella. Now, if I kill him, well, he wouldn't work anymore. I've been trying to imagine it. Marv Carpenter lying on the ground with his eyes glaring open and his mouth twisted and never going to hold a piece of wood in his hands again or never going to sing a song or have a beer or anything. Well, it just made me kind of sick. I mean, I could go on with the thieving, but murder...
Yeah, I know, but Tom, it's your job. It's for the good of the village.
Murder. I better have another beer. Hey, what's that?
That must be the inspector's ship landing. Come on, let's go see.
Perimeter guard, advance. Set up portable generators and rocket launchers. All personnel restricted to immediate area of the ship. Sidearms to be worn at all times. And guards at battle station.
Welcome to New Delaware.
Thank you, General. I'm the inspector. This is Mr. Grant, my political advisor.
Is this the capital of the colony?
Well, I'm afraid there's only this village on the whole of New Delaware.
Only one? Now, Grant, I told you when we surveyed the planet we were wasting our time.
Patience. There's always an advantage in every situation.
If you gentlemen are ready...
Ready?
You're going to inspect our village, aren't you?
Inspect? I can see it all.
Of course, General. We're ready. Let's inspect your village.
You see, we've got it all. Jail, post office, church, little red schoolhouse. Oh, we're very normal. Very earthy.
Rent, I have my efficiency rating to think of. This place is worthless. No smelting, no heavy industry, no atomics, no taxation, no... They don't have anything.
Oh, I wouldn't say that, Inspector. If you'll excuse us, General.
Of course. I'll be downgraded at the next colonial board. Why, this place is a utopia. It's subversive. We ought to blow it right out of the sky.
No, don't be despondent, Inspector.
But this whole trip is a total waste of time.
Not entirely. New Delaware has a very important commodity for us.
What? You saw them? Hulking peasants? Nothing but farmers.
Yes, strong, healthy farmers. Good cannon fodder.
But...
Ooh, let me take over. General.
Yes, sir?
How many able young men are there in the village between the ages of 15 and 60?
Why?
You see, General, Imperial Earth is engaged in a war. The colonies in Deng Four are revolting against the authority of Mother Earth.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
We need good, healthy fighting men. Our reserves are depleted.
We wish to give all loyal colonists a chance to fight for Mother Earth. We're sure you won't refuse. Most colonies welcome a little conscription. Cleanses the blood. Reduces crime.
Crime? Oh, I thought that would come up. We've taken care of that. I appointed...
Now, you see, Grant. 60, 70, perhaps 100 recruits. Not such a waste of time coming here at all.
Perhaps not.
Sergeant, detail a squad of 50 men armed with portable heat generators to post a guard in the village. All right, Mr. Mayor. Suppose we go talk this problem over.
Tom, you out there?
Yeah. I've been skulking out here all day. I'm hungry.
Well, I brought you supper. The mayor sent you a message, Tom. He said to hurry up at the murder. He's been stalling the inspector and that nasty little Grint man, but they're going to ask him. They're sure to.
All right, all right. I'll get around to it tonight. Hey. Hey, wait a minute.
Oh, hello, Tom.
What are you doing?
Well, you said there had to be a murder, so
I... Now, wait. I didn't mean me. It can't be me.
Well, why not?
Well, for one thing, somebody has to talk to the inspector. He's waiting for me. Someone has to show him how to
do that. You think a knife would be more fatal in the heart or in the throat? Well, nothing personal, of course.
Wait. If there's nothing personal, then you have no motive.
Oh. Well, I guess I could think of one. I've been pretty sore about you appointing me town criminal.
It was the mayor who appointed you, wasn't it?
Well, sure.
Then look, I'm not a mayor anymore. I'm a general. Look, the stars, gold braid.
Well, what's that got to do with it?
Well, you missed the ceremony this afternoon, Tom. Inspector said I had to wear a general's uniform. It was a very friendly ceremony. All the Earthmen were grinning. They were winking at me and at each other.
Oh, congratulations. But you were the mayor when you appointed me criminal, so my motive still holds.
Yes, but killing a general isn't murder. It's mutiny.
Oh. Oh. Well, I'm sorry.
That's all right. It's just that I've read up on it, and you haven't. Well, I better get back. The inspector wants a lot of the men that he can draft.
Are you sure this murder is necessary?
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely. Just not me.
No luck, huh, Tom?
I just can't do it. Ed... I can't kill anybody in the village. I grew up with them. I've worked with them. I've drunk root beer with them. I don't have any motive for killing any of them.
I know, but you do have to commit a murder, Tom. You don't want to let the village down.
But I can't kill the people I've known all my life.
No, I suppose not.
Wait. Wait a minute. I got an idea. Ed, suppose I kill the inspector.
Well, what's your motive?
Oh, it would be a very terrible crime. I'd be killing for glory, for fame, for notoriety... And it'll show Earth how earthy New Delaware really is. Why, they'll say crime is so bad here that a criminal actually killed their inspector on the very first day.
Tom, that's just the sort of thing a master criminal would do.
Oh, you think it's a good idea, huh?
I think it's great, Tom. But how are you going to do it?
Well, one of those soldiers got drunk in a bottle of your Keebler juice and dropped his gun. I picked it up.
Oh, is that a gun?
Yeah, you push this button here. Hey, look out! I'm sorry, Ed.
Now I'll have to get the carpenter boys to fix that hole in the roof.
Oh, well, I'll be careful.
Did you kill the soldier?
Of course not. No point in killing the wrong man. Well, I better get going. I'll wait for him on the path between the mayor's house and the ship.
Good luck, Tom.
Thanks.
Up, two, three, four... Keep in line there.
Ah, what a sloppy crew. All left feet.
Well, it's a nice night's work. And those landing parties dying like flies, we can use every new man we can get.
Don't say that.
What, are you afraid the mayor will hear me? Don't be ridiculous. It's a completely passive population. Sheep-like, obedient.
Look at them. No two of them in step.
Well, what do you expect from backward agrarians? Wait till those sergeants get hold of them at the base. They'll whip them into first-class fighting men in no time.
Halt! Stand and deliver!
What's that?
Why, it's Tom.
Hands up, Inspector. I got you covered. Now, the rest of you drop your guns and move out of the way.
What? Now, see here.
Now, go on. Now, drop those guns.
Now, what's the meaning of this?
And who are you?
Tom Fisher. I'm the town criminal. I'm going to kill the inspector. Now, please move out of the way.
Criminal? So that's what the mayor was prattling about.
Now, I know we haven't had any murders in 200 years... But I'm changing that now. Now move out of the way.
Well, I suppose I'd better get out of the line of fire.
No, no, wait a minute. Wait.
Now don't move. I know just how to do it. I've been thinking about it. Now I'll push this button and you'll die. You'll fall down on the path and your eyes will open and your mouth twisted and no air going in and out of your lungs and no beat to your heart and I can't do it. Here's your gun. Take it. I don't want it.
Quick, after him. Sergeant, take a squad and search the forest.
Take it easy, Inspector. This whole planet is forest. 10,000 men couldn't find him if he doesn't want to be.
But gone. I'll have him hanged on the spot.
Oh, I'm terribly sorry.
Sergeant, have the entire ship's company turned out. General, I want all your people out looking for him. Shoot out sights. Kill him instantly.
Oh, we couldn't do that. Although we appreciate the compliment.
What? What? That man?
He's a criminal. That's what I'm trying to explain. I appointed him. We had to have one.
You what?
You mean...
You had no criminals?
I'm afraid not. Oh, I'm terribly ashamed. You see, we knew how uncivilized we were, and that's why we did it. I'm dreadfully embarrassed that Tom couldn't handle the job.
Well, why did you give the assignment to that particular man?
Well, I figured if anyone could kill, Tom could. He's a fisherman, you know. Pretty gory work. Oh.
And he wasn't able to kill the inspector.
Well, we just haven't had to kill anything for 200 years except fish. The only animals on New Delaware are small grass eaters, and they're not good to eat, so we never kill any of them.
Then the rest of you would be equally unable to kill?
We wouldn't even get as far as Tom did.
I want that man found!
About it, Inspector.
What?
We'd better get away from here. You want men in our army who can't kill?
Ooh.
Think of it. A morale problem.
Ooh.
The possibility of infection. One man in a key position endangering a key ship, or maybe a whole fleet because he can't kill. It isn't worth the risk, Inspector.
Yes, sir. I see what you mean.
Order your troops back to the ship. We'll take off at once.
Tom! Tom, you can come out now. Tom, they're gone.
He's hiding around here somewhere, Mayor.
Yeah. Tom! Tom!
Here I am. I'm sorry I bungled it.
Well, don't feel bad about it. It was an impossible job.
I'm afraid it was. I thought that just possibly you could swing it, but you can't be blamed, Tom. There's not another man in the village who could have done the job even as well.
What are we going to do with all those buildings, Mayor? The jail, the post office, the little red schoolhouse, the church?
Well, I think we'll build a playground for the kids with swings and slides and sandboxes for them.
Another playground?
Surely, why not?
Well, I guess I won't be needing my skulking permit anymore.
No, I guess not. Oh, well, we did our best.
I had the chance, then I let you all down.
It's not your fault, Tom. Look how long it took Earth to get civilized. Thousands of years. And we were trying to do it in 2 weeks.
Well, we'll just have to go back to being uncivilized.
Yeah.
Well, we better get back to the village. Looks like rain.
Well, soon I'll start fishing again. Say.
What is it, Tom?
Oh, it's too late now, but it's too bad I didn't think of it before. I might have been able to go through with it.
Think of what, Tom?
I think I could have done it. If I'd only had the sense to think of the inspector as a fish. Well, it's too late now. Guess he's just a big one. He's got away.
You've just heard X-1, presented by the National Broadcasting Company, in cooperation with Galaxy Science Fiction Magazine, which this month features an unusual story by James E. Gunn, Cylana, a story of what happened when crime suddenly invaded a crimeless society, and where the only way to catch a thief was to manufacture a thief. Galaxy Magazine, on your newsstand today. Tonight, by transcription, X-1 has brought you Skulking Permit, a story from the pages of Galaxy, written by Robert Sheckley and adapted for radio by Ernest Canoy. Featured in the cast were Dick Hamilton, Wendell Holmes, Joe DeSantis, Joseph Boland, Alan Hewitt, Bill Quinn, Mandel Kramer, and Ruby Dee. Your announcer, Jack Costello. X-1 was directed by Daniel Sutter and is an NBC Radio Network production. Let's visit Fibber McGee and Molly tonight on the NBC Radio Network.
Over the magic island of Euclidia, that weird, soft darkness of the South Seas is beginning to steal. It's after 7 o'clock in the evening, and the Gregory boat is to attempt its escape promptly at 8 o'clock. Jerry and Joan have gone down into the lower levels of the island to aid the escape by putting some of the Euclidean machinery out of order. In the radio cabin of the Gregory yacht, lashed to the boat which was to have rescued them all, Captain Bradford and Mrs. Gregory are making last-minute preparations for the dash to freedom. They are waiting for word from Jerry and Joan, in the hope that it may be possible to get a radio message off to Johnson.
I know all that, Tex, but why don't we hear from them?
No, take it easy, Pat. Those kids left here at 6:30. It's only about 7:20 now. They've been gone less than an hour. Joan said it would take them over an hour to cover all the places they had to go on the island, even if they had good luck.
That's it. If they had good luck. Don't you realize all the terrible things that might have happened to them in the last 45 minutes?
Of course I realize what might have happened, dear, but...
They're down there inside that awful island somewhere, trying to upset the workings of a mechanically perfect fortress. Just two children against the most powerful scientific combination the world has ever known. Why, G-47 alone is dangerous enough without...
G-47 is sound asleep in his chemical laboratory, Pat. He can't do anything to harm those kids.
But he has assistants and guards all over the place, to say nothing of all the mechanical and electrical devices which automatically protect the inner workings of the island.
Yes, and don't forget that Joan has lived 14 years on this island. She has had the freedom of it as a child. She probably knows every nook and cranny of it, as well as the Euclideans themselves.
Tex, the alarm gong. It struck once, then five times. What does that mean?
I'm not sure, Pat. But I think the five strokes mean the fifth level of the island. That's where the chemical laboratory is.
Then it might mean that Jerry and Joan have been caught on that level. Perhaps some of the chemists woke up before you expected it, and they've caught Jerry and Joan.
No, you're just making that up, Pat. We didn't expect them back until just before 8. Joan said it might be necessary for them to remain hidden on the island, and only rush to join us here on the boat at the last minute. So we'll have to go ahead and make sure our arrangements are complete to shove off at 8. And just hope the kids make it as we're ready to leave.
Sorry, Tex. I let myself go, I guess.
Come in. Oh, Mac. Come in and close the door.
I've just come to tell you that all's been done that can be done about getting the other boat ready.
That's fine, Mac. Thanks a lot.
Everything out of the hold? All the supplies?
Aye. They're all transferred to the diesel cruiser. And it was no small job getting them through that hole down on the waterline.
How about that hole, Tex? When will we cover it?
We'll have to sail with it open. We'll leave this boat through the holes and cast off immediately.
That hole is very close to the waterline, Captain. We'll ship a lot of water going out through that swell.
Can't be helped. We'd be caught sure if we tried to cover it here between the piers. I've got a good temporary hatch we can slam in there. By hanging some mats over the hatch, we can be fairly safe.
Remember that we can't use the pumps, Tex. We'll need all the fuel to run the motor.
Yes, and then some. How far have we got a chance to get on that fuel, Mac?
If we slip out of here under sail and keep the sail up after we start the motor, we ought to make 75 miles. There'll be a brisk wind to help us a bit later, I think.
But if we're moving slowly enough for the sail to help us any, we can't make over 15 or 20 knots.
Well, we'll see what the situation is when we sail. Jerry and Joan may give us enough leeway so that we can take our time.
Then again, supposing we are caught, we'll have to drag them aboard openly and run for it.
Well, in that case, we'll open the motors wide and let her roar as far as the oil lasts. And hope we can get a message to Johnson before he gets too far north to run back to our aid.
Well, what does that thing mean?
We're not sure, but it's probably something about the chemical laboratory on the fifth level of the island, where the captain's formula put all those scientists to sleep.
Oh, now, did you know it would do that, Captain?
Yes, and it should keep them asleep long enough to give us a chance to be many miles from this island when they wake up.
But it will also make them very angry when they do wake up.
That can't be helped, Mac. They haven't any love for us as it is. They've only allowed us the freedom we've had in the hopes they'd get another formula of Texas. And if we don't escape, they'll finally find a way to get it.
Well, I'll shove off to the other boat. Let me know as soon as you have news of the young people on the island, if you please.
We'll keep you posted, Johnson.
I wonder if we've really fooled anyone on the island, Tex.
You mean about Johnson being on another boat and our calling McLeod Johnson?
Yes.
I think so, Pat. Why should they think otherwise?
Jerry said that woman submarine commander knew Johnson wasn't aboard that boat when it arrived. And if she knew it, why not others on the island?
You know, I think Jerry was right about her. She's fed up with this island and these cold-blooded inhuman machines who call themselves Euclideans. She wants to see our world and learn something of the natural, happy way we live.
That's all true enough. And I think we can trust her. The fact that she deliberately walked into that laboratory and let the gas put her to sleep so it'd help Jerry and Joan get away safely, all that proves her sincerity. But what I meant was, why couldn't someone else on the island have detected Johnson's absence in the same manner as herself?
Well, of course, there's a chance of all that, Pat, but Well, we've got to hope for the best.
That was different, Tex. The gong struck 6 times then.
Yeah. I wonder what's happening on the 6th level. That was what it meant.
I'm afraid it has something to do with Jerry and Joan.
Oh, now you're letting your imagination run away with you, Pat. You don't know any more about what's happening on that island than I do. And that's not much.
That was 7, Tex. 7 strokes on that gong. That'd mean the 7th level. I know it's something about Jerry and Joan. They're being followed, Tex. I can feel it.
Steady, Pat. You don't know anything of the kind.
Did you hear it, Tex? 8. The 8th level. They are following them down into the depths of the island.
Stop it, Pat. Stop it. You're hysterical. You're just imagining things.
I can see them now, Tex. Just as if I were with them. Those terrible bells following them from floor to floor as they try to escape. That was 9, Jerry. The alarm has come to the 9th floor, just 1 above us. We must do this quickly.
Right, Joan. You throw these switches, I'll open the valves. Then we run out fast. Come on, kid. Filling up with water awfully fast. Were those men drowned in there?
No, Jerry. They can use airlocks and escape.
Okay. Let's move fast. Where now?
That was 10, Jerry. For this floor. In a moment, the floor will be full of guards looking for us.
How can we get out of here?
Come, Jerry. We must run. I will tell you as we go. We must go back to the noisy elevator shaft.
But somebody might be coming down that way.
They will be coming down always. But I have one desperate hope.
Yeah? What's that?
Remember, I told you that there were doors in both sides of that elevator shaft.
Yeah?
Right. Oh, Jerry. We are here. I am breathing heavily.
Well, never mind. Breathing. What do we do?
First, we must open the door into the shaft, cross the shaft, and go out the other side. I know how to get from there to the top of the island.
Come on, then. Here goes. Now, we just went straight across the bottom of this shaft and out the other side, huh?
Yes, Jim.
Hey, the elevator's coming down on us. We can't make it.
We've got to make it. Run across, Jerry.
Boy.
Are you all right, Jerry?
If I could get my heart out of my mouth so I could talk, I'd tell you.
We barely made it, Jerry. That elevator car touched my dress as I came through the door.
Can they get out of this door after us?
No. I have locked it on this side.
Well, that gives us time to breathe anyway. Now, where do we go from here?
We have no choice now, Jerry. We have shut off all the power on the island. Except what is in the batteries in the radio chamber and 1 private elevator. The Euclideans can do very little to follow our boat when we escape.
When we escape? You mean if we escape.
But we will escape. But now come, Jerry. There's a long spiral ramp from here to the surface of the island. It is very steep, and it will be a long, hard, dangerous climb. But we must attempt it.
You mean that steel, slippery thing over there? That looks like a chute to slide things down?
Yes, that is exactly what it is. The Euclideans built it so that supplies and materials taken from boats which had to be destroyed quickly could be shot down here to safety as the island was submerged.
And we've got to climb up that corkscrew tunnel? 100 feet straight up a thing that was made to shoot baggage down in a hurry?
Yes, Jerry. We will take off our shoes. I think the channel is narrow enough so that we may press our hands and feet against the sides and work our way up.
Okay, kid. I can stand it if you can. Gee, but you're the bravest girl I ever saw.
I'm happy to have you say that, Jerry. Hurry with the shoes.
Are there any doors in that thing? I mean, can anybody look into it from any of these levels and catch us as we go past?
There is only one other opening. That is on the fifth level. There is also a little platform there on which we may rest.
Well, that helps a little. 50 feet, then we rest. Then some guy sticks his head out a door and catches us resting.
We can only hope that no one suspects we are doing this.
I'm kind of worried about all those fellows we let the water in on, down in that power room.
They will all escape, Jerry. Each man has an airlock. They simply step into them and shoot to the surface of the island as if in a torpedo tube.
Well, let's start climbing this thing. Joan, listen. Isn't that the signal to submerge?
Yes, Jerry. The island will be submerged.
Then what happens to us and your mother and Captain Bradford out there in that boat?
I do not know, Jerry. All we can do is hope and climb.
Signal to submerge the magic island, the weird island of Euclidea. On board the Gregory yacht, Captain Bradford and Mrs. Gregory hurriedly transfer their valuables to the other captive boat, which is to be used in the escape, as they await anxiously for word from Jerry and Joan. The youngsters have gone down into the mysterious depths of the island in a brave attempt to cripple the Euclidean machinery and postpone pursuit of the Gregory boat. The boat is supposed to steal out of the lock at 8 o'clock. It is now after 7:30. How can Jerry and Joan get back to the yacht in time? If they get back at all. They are now making their way up a narrow and dangerous spiral concrete tube running from the top to the bottom of the island.
Are you doing all right, Joan?
I'm very tired, Jerry, but I will reach the platform.
Gee, we've climbed 50 feet up the inside of this cement baggage chute.
Not quite. It will be 50 feet when we get to that little platform.
Okay, kid. Don't lose your nerve. Now then, I've got my back braced against this thing. I think I can hold you. Let one of your feet slide. Slow now.
Right.
Slide it down the wall and see if I can hold it with my hand.
I feel as if I would fall, Jerry. You must hurry.
I got your foot all right, Joan. Now, I'll push as hard as I can without sliding down this thing. You try to crawl up far enough to get your hands over the edge of the platform. Ready?
I nearly have it. Yes, I have my hands on it.
Good. Then start pulling yourself up as hard as you can. I'll help you.
I think I can get on it now. Oh, Jerry, I am up.
Oh. Swell. Now, if I can only stick here like a fly until I get my breath, I'll see if I can get up there.
This platform is large enough for me to lie down on. I will lie flat and hold my arms down to you. Then I can help you up.
Yeah. If I don't pull you off of there and both of us shoot down this thing again.
Oh, Jerry, I have found a small concrete arch behind which I may hook my heels. So, now I will be able to hold you. Give me your hand. Don't be afraid, Jerry. I can hold you easily.
Okay. Now I get my elbow up on this thing. Here we come. Oh, boy.
Oh, that was a terrible experience. And we are only halfway up now. This platform is on the fifth level.
Well, then we'll just have to go out into the fifth level, take our chances with what we find there. Neither of us can make another 50 feet of that.
You are right. It would be impossible.
Our hands and feet are probably all cut up now. Climbing 50 feet in a concrete pipe with your bare hands and stocking feet doesn't put you in very good shape for more climbing.
I think we are in our bare feet now, Jerry. The stockings must be cut to ribbons.
Oh, can I turn my flashlight on for a minute? I want to see what shape we're in before we run out there. We can be ready to answer questions about what happened to us when we find out what did happen.
I think you may use the light, Jerry.
Okay. Oh, gee, Joan. Your feet are cut up awful bad. I'm sorry.
Oh, do not stop to be sorry now, Jerry. Listen.
Gee, they're still submerging this thing.
No, Jerry. They have not started to submerge it as yet.
But we heard the signal when we started to climb up here. And that must have taken us 15 or 20 minutes.
But the signal we heard just now, those six strokes on the alarm gong, means to stand by all stations to submerge. It must be that they are having trouble with the submerging operation.
Well, I hope we've fixed up their old power plant so they can't ever submerge this crazy Euclidea again.
There is little hope there. It will be only a matter of time until they pump out the water that we let into the power chambers.
Then let's get going. We've got to make it to that radio room on the top and get a message off to Johnson before this goes under.
That signal to submerge will have taken all men to their stations, and there are no control stations in the sound channel. This platform opens off the sound channel. We will have to take a desperate chance, Jerry.
That won't be anything new for us. What is it?
We must cross the sound room and enter the private elevator of the control group.
Well, I'm ready to take the chance. Where will that elevator take us?
Directly into the voice transmission chambers on the surface of Euclidea. Then we will have to take over the controls and send the message.
Sounds easy. Okay, my little barefoot boy. Here we go.
Open the door gently, Jerry. Be sure that no one is in the sound chamber.
Yeah, check. Huh? No. Looks okay. I'm glad this is one of those noiseless doors.
Go on into the room, Jerry. We must hurry.
Yeah. Here we go, then. Now, where is that elevator?
In that corner of the room. We must pass through the sound zone. Do not shout as you did before.
Okay, I'll watch it. But what are we going to do if we find somebody waiting for us at the top of that elevator? Hey, listen to my voice.
Yes, Jerry, I warned you not to shout.
And now our bare feet sound like we had boots on.
We will be out of the zone in a few steps.
It'll be all right with me. I like noise when I want it, but when I'm trying to be quiet and... Hey, now the voice comes out right side up again.
And we are approaching the private elevator.
And when we get in this thing, can they hear our voices in the control room?
Certainly. We will be able to say nothing until we arrive in the control room on the surface level. Then I will speak to the guard, find some excuse to make him turn his back to me, and use the ray gun on him. That will give you 5 minutes to get the message to Johnson. Now open the door, Jerry.
Okay.
Speak no word until we meet the guard.
Yeah. You'd better run the elevator when we get in it. I never saw how this one works.
I shall do so. We may count the levels as we pass by the magnets moving the car. Now, silence.
At which time you will report immediately to the control chamber. Station 91. Station 91. You will use all speed in discovering cause of delay in submerging. Check the entire ninth level by photoray. At which time you will report immediately to the control chamber. Emergency diving stations. Signal to submerge. Repeat at 60-second intervals until operation begins. Signal stand by to submerge. Clear all channels to this chamber. Execute. What are you doing here, Cleostra?
I have come with this prisoner. He was given permission to go to the laboratory to aid in reviving the sleeping scientists. When we arrived at the laboratory, he refused. I was instructed to return him to the surface.
You, young man, sit over there, in that steel chair. Not there, over here. Must I put you in the chair?
Gee, you did it again, Joan. You're sure slick with that ray gun.
He will sleep for 5 minutes, Jerry. That is not long. We must operate the voice transmission apparatus at once.
Is he the only guard in this place?
In this room, yes. Though in the power dispatching chamber directly below us, another guard is on duty.
Well, wouldn't he hear this ray gun go off?
No. That door leads to his room. It is closed and soundproof.
This seems too easy to me. Is there always just one guard in these places?
Of course not. But the others are busy trying to revive the sleeping chemists and preparing to submerge the island.
Yes, but I think...
Oh, Jerry, please. This is no time to argue. I will set the transmitter on the northerly directional beam. We must raise Johnson at once. I will also close all these local communication circuits so that there is no danger of anything we say being heard elsewhere on the island. Oh, Jerry.
Huh? What's the matter now?
This microphone was open. The intercommunicating circuit to the lower level.
Gee, then somebody might have heard that ray gun.
Yes. Hurry with the message, Jerry.
Well, where do I talk? I mean, where's the beam thing I want?
Directly in front of you now, Jerry. I will give you the message quietly. You may repeat it. Get any station quickly.
Right. Here we go. J12C, Jerry Hall to any station. Emergency. Can you hear me, Wilmington? Hurry it up. Hello, J12C. Hello.
Hello. Waiting for hours with vent wide open. Shoot it fast. I'm ready.
Here it comes. Take it over, Joan. You can save time if I don't have to repeat it.
Joan Gregory to J12C. Message from Bradford. This is it. Every indication going have trouble. Possibly may feel unwise even leave free in this yacht. Many islanders lying in forced sleep. Doesn't indicate especially sincere enjoyment. Longer unusual silence envelops. Our waiting now. Perhaps later advice, nearer solution. That is all.
Right. Checking now. Your position sounds hopeless, but we'll let you know if I can contact the ship station. Anything else?
That is all.
Nice work, Joan. Johnson's got our message. But how far from the island is he, and how long will it take him to get here?
I have copied his answer. I think the captain will have a code for it.
Got your message here on the yacht. Good work, kids, but it's no use. They're pulling the yacht inside the lock again, and we're going to be submerged with the island. Better stay where you are. Dangerous to try getting back to yacht now.
We'll be all right here, Tex. We'll come through the island and meet you in the lock.
Right. Have cut Johnson's boat adrift. Orders from the island. Lock too small for two boats. So Johnson's boat is a total loss. Drifting out to sea.
The captain said they had cut the other boat loose, Jerry. And the yacht is being taken into the lock. Oh, that is wonderful.
You bet it's wonderful. Those guys don't know they're taking an empty boat into the lock. And that Captain Bradford and your mother and all our friends are on the boat they've turned loose. It's out in the open water now, Joan. The boat is free.
They've started to submerge, Jerry. In a moment, this room will be going underwater.
Then we'll swim for it. Come on, Joan. At least we can float, but Euclidea is sunk.
Fella means when he says it was a fair fight. Turns out to be, I won the way I expected to. Avak was in a position that they weren't supposed to win. They were going to have to use an unexpected method. Of course, that would be called unfair, wouldn't it?
Right over here, Captain Bratton. Just take a seat, and I'll be with you in a moment.
Oh, thanks.
Nothing special the immigration department wants to see me about, is there?
I mean, if it's those little fungoid life forms you're worried about.
No, Captain, it's not fungoid life forms. Let's see. Your ship just arrived here, Terra, an hour ago.
Yes, we docked at LaGuardia Field at 4 p.m. In fact, I haven't even had time
Your crew left the ship yet?
No, sir. After all, I am conscious of the great responsibility we inter-system cargo carriers have regarding the importation of non-terrestrial toxins and microbodies and unicellular
life. Captain, I'm not a bacteriologist. My name's Jeffy. I'm a psychologist.
I see, sir.
Just what do you see?
You're making a check to see if I'm spaceworthy, not neurotic or cracking up under the stress. And you jot down notes, and just from little slips a man makes because he's tired and needs a rest and a shower and a couple of beers at a high-class bar and maybe a few days of quiet in the country, away from always worrying about a media breaking through the hull.
Oh, I admit I am somewhat knocked out. Who wouldn't be?
I brought this cargo in from Deneb. We've been out there between systems, the long haul, for 13 months. Now, we've got nothing to apologize for. You let me rest up. How about trying that instead of badgering us with psychological questions?
I'm sorry, Captain. Now, let's see. You visited the sixth planet to the Deneb system. Avak or something like that?
Avak.
Did you and your crew enjoy your stay there? They treated us okay. We were 3 weeks loading. During that time, we mostly just strolled around taking things easy. Wasn't much to see. Mostly just small towns, factories. They make ceramic household goods. That was our cargo, in fact. That's a darn small planet they've got there, sir, and overcrowded. Every half mile, there's a factory going like crazy, and the air's so full of smoke from the stacks you can hardly breathe. Sir, they've got almost no raw materials. But out of what they have, plus the synthetics they've developed, they're able to turn out so much pottery that you'll find it everywhere in the galaxy. It's amazing. Every system you visit, you see vases, salt shakers, flower pots. They're all marked, made at Avak. Just think what they could do if they had a sufficient supply of raw materials. Makes you wonder.
Yes, it does make you wonder.
They fought a little war back about 10 years with the other planets of their system. Beat them, too. But it didn't do them any good. The other planets were just as depleted.
Captain, I want you to examine something.
Oh, yes, sir. That's an Avakian space mine. Seeks out the target by beaming in on the target's heat. They used that in a couple of three wars.
Awful thing. Look at that boring snout.
Mm-hmm.
I'm told it cuts its way through the hull of a ship to the wall of a building until it actually gets to a living creature. Then?
Yes, sir. It's a vicious weapon. The troops call them leeches. Bet that was 10 years ago, sir. Now they're a commercial planet. They threw out the military leaders and voted in a business administration. They're all for trade and culture exchange now. They learned their lesson.
Did they? Captain, while you were on Avak, did you buy and bring back here with you any toys for your children?
Just as a fair fight hasn't been well defined, neither is the concept toy. Take a portable typewriter, for instance. Is this a toy for a child? Or is it the working tool of a newspaper reporter? It isn't really what the thing is, but how you think about it, what you intend to do with it. What is a toy? A toy for children.
While you were on Avak, did you buy and bring back here with you any toys for your children?
Well, as a matter of fact,
I'd like to see what toys you bought on Avak. Let's have a look.
Pull it back on the ship in my cabin.
Captain, I'd like you to glance at this particular toy. It showed up a month or so ago. Possibly you saw something like it in the store in Avak.
It looks like an ordinary set of model soldiers to me. British grenadiers, I guess. Very authentic, too. Gosh, look at the detail on the uniforms.
Yes, it's amazing. You'd think they were real. Genuine British soldiers of centuries ago, standing 3 inches high. And their cannons. You'd almost expect those cannons to fire, wouldn't you?
Fine workmanship.
Well, Captain, the cannons do fire.
No kidding.
I'll show you. I'm using now what is called a ramrod.
Uh-huh.
Ramming the powder and shot in. Just a second. There. Now it's ready.
They must use watchmaker's tools, microscopic precision.
I'll fire it out the window. Ready?
Ready.
Guys, will you begin clearing the debris? I'm sorry, I meant it to explode entirely outside the building. Must have caught a corner of the window.
This is terrible.
Now, to the soldiers. They're dead, of course.
Dead?
Well, let's say inert. We destroyed their neural systems with high voltage.
What?
We simply took the cartons of soldiers and put a charge through them. They're fragile. It's hard, even for a people uniquely talented in microscopic assembly, to produce a workable robot only 3 inches high.
I see. Of course, robots.
Yeah, look at this.
Why, well, I'd say this is, but it looks like a little toy telephone set. Gosh, we had those when I was a kid. Talk to the kid across the street, transmit for a block or more.
Talk into it. Here, I'll get out the mate and answer you. In fact, I'll go stand over here, away from you with it.
Okay, Captain, can you hear me?
I hear you, sir.
Say something foul.
Sir?
You're a spaceman. Think of the foulest oath you can remember. Say it into the phone.
Okay, sir. You know, sir, it's the darndest thing. I guess I must be nervous. I can't.
Try.
I can't, sir. I can't think of anything foul.
All right. That's what I wanted to show you, Captain. The horn acts to inhibit the speech center of persons near it. Sort of damper. Actually, the technique was known to us. We used it during World War III, during brain cleansing therapy.
Uh-huh.
You know, obliterating hostilities from the minds of enemy prisoners.
Sure.
But to incorporate it into a child's toy. You see, Captain, a child exposed to this mechanism over a long period of time would develop a docility, a passivity, an inability to feel angry or aggressive. In other words...
brain cleansed.
Now look at this.
What, seems to be... Yes, it's one of those question and answer games. You get a buzz if you guess the right answer.
I'll fit a question sheet over the terminals. With this toy, the child develops a rudimentary knowledge of natural facts on a variety of topics. Now, let's see. This top sheet consists of questions on growing plants and flowers.
Yeah, well, let's try something different.
All right, how about great composers?
No, I think I'd like to try this sheet titled The Human Body. I used to know something about that. I took a college correspondence course in biology during a long trip out.
Very well. I'll plug in question three. The digestive system breaks down protein foods into what simple molecule?
Amino acids. Answer number nine. Plug the answer wire onto the number nine terminal.
I agree. Amino acids is right.
Well, what's the matter then? Works normally.
I'll try it the way we started. Question three with answer nine. You won't get a buzz this time.
Well, but we did get a buzz, and it's right.
Yes, we got a buzz before. But we won't get one now. See, Captain, there's a circuit in this thing that randomizes the buzz. The child using this so-called educational toy will get correct answers to start with. Then the randomization sets in, and before he is sure enough of his own knowledge to contradict it, his meager fund of accurate facts will be gradually distorted. Not wiped out, but altered more and more, until he is confused.
But why?
So he'll be convinced that there is no such thing as a correct answer. And now I'd like to see the toys you brought back with you. Let's go to your ship and have a look at them.
Won the last war always wants his methods of fighting a war to be the ultimate weapons, because he wins with those. But what is the real ultimate weapon? A weapon that no other weapon can touch. How about the weapon of changing your enemy into a friend, or changing your enemy so he doesn't even try to defeat you? Wouldn't that be a more powerful weapon than any possible attacking device?
This is my younger kid, Charles. He's nine.
What is it?
Well, can't you tell?
It looks like a costume.
Yeah, I'll spread it out.
What kind of a costume is it? I don't see any identifying features. Looks more like a sack. A gray sack.
I shopped around Avak for days before I ran across this.
Yeah, I'll put it on.
Yeah, right sleeve. And left.
There. Explain it, Captain.
But can't you see?
No, you're simply inside a gray sack. That's all I can see.
I'm a cowboy.
What?
This is a cowboy suit. More than that. Of course, it takes a few minutes.
Good Lord. It's changing color.
So am I. Changing me into a cowboy. Darn it, I said I was a cowboy, and I am. Now, I don't mean I'm just pretending to be a cowboy. I mean, as long as I'm wearing this material around me, I actually become a cowboy. Notice I've got chaps on my legs. I put this on a couple of times on the trip back, me and the crew both. Really got a kick out of it. Looky here. I got me a six gun.
Where did that gun come from?
Grew out of the suit.
And your head's expanding and turning black.
Nah. That's my 10-gallon black felt hat.
Incredible.
Put him up, partner.
Why, your skin looks like leather.
Is that your idea of a humorous remark, partner?
Take it off. Take one off. That material, before it's too late. Take it off before you're so far down in that fantasy world you can't get back. Like they intended it. Take it off.
Just when I was beginning to enjoy myself. You know, friend, when I was just a little tyke, I used to pine to be back in the good old days and ride the reins. Back when you could smell the sagebrush growing out in the free country where... What was I saying?
By a cowboy. Why, I always wanted to be a cowboy.
Would it be the same for me, I wonder?
Oh, no,
put it on?
It's whatever your fantasy is. Now, Charles probably will use it to become a 20th century businessman. Gray flannel suit, Ivy League. He reads all those old adventures about New York before it was destroyed. Those advertising operas.
Give me that material. I'm impounding it.
But why? What's wrong? It just helps a kid act out perfectly normal childhood fantasies. Charles plays advertising exec all day long. With this, he can...
A child couldn't possibly hold out against me. It almost got you, and you're a grown man. Do you want to lose your child? Is that what you want? Do you want to see him disappear down into a fantasy world and never return? Let's see what else you brought back.
Yeah. Only one more toy. Actually, it's a game for my older boy, Pete. He's 12.
Open it up.
Yeah. It's called Enterprise. I figure all the kids in the block can play. It's a lot of fun. A bunch of us played it on the trip back.
Can two play?
Mm-hmm. Two players up to eight.
Very well, let's play.
Each player buys shares with money borrowed from the other players. Now, at any time, a creditor can demand payment either in shares or in money. But as soon as a player ceases to extend credit, he must show what shares he holds. He has to show which groups he's been able to get control of. From then on, he has to bid out in the open, with everyone else knowing what he's got shares.
I bid 3,000 solar units for 2 shares of Neptune Non-Ferric Ores Incorporated.
Make it 4,000 and the shares are yours.
4,000.
Sold. Okay. Now, you owe me 600,000 solar units. And I owe you 355,000 solar units. I demand payment of the difference.
Let's see. I don't have 245,000 units worth of stock.
Yes, you do. If you turn in your Martian diamond mines, limited.
Oh, but that's my best bluff. That corners you from the inner planets.
Put it in or call the game over.
All right, it's in.
Game's over.
But why?
I have enough solar units left to buy all your remaining stock. So in terms of profit and loss, you're wiped out.
Yes, I guess you're right. Very well, you wind up with 3 expensive groups. And I don't have any.
Well, do you see anything harmful in this game? All I can see myself is that it teaches a child the basic fact of economic life. And that's something every child should know.
I have to admit I find nothing subversive in this game. In fact, it's nothing but a variant of an old Terran parlor game called Monopoly. Yes, you can retain this toy, Captain. It meets with immigration specifications.
Well, that's a relief.
Sorry to have caused you so much trouble. I'll go and interview your crew and see what children's artifacts they brought back. You can go to your hotel now.
Can you find your way around the ship?
Oh, yes, I'm used to it. I'll see you again, and next time you're done.
All right.
Hope your children enjoy playing Enterprise. Matter of fact, I enjoyed it myself. Might have you bring in a set for me next night.
Sure. Anything to accommodate the immigration department. Well, I better get all the pieces back in the box before they get lost. Heck, in that game, Monopoly, the player who wound up with the most money and property won the game. And in Enterprise, the winner is the one who's wiped out. Hey, I'll bet he didn't realize he beat me. But he didn't have a solar unit or a share of stock left. He won by a clean sweep.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman.
Up in the sky, look! It's a bird!
It's a plane!
It's Superman! And now, Superman, mighty visitor from the destroyed planet Krypton, who has appeared on Earth as the champion of the weak and the oppressed, faster than a speeding bullet, stronger than a locomotive, with a physical structure never before realized by mortal men, Superman goes about among human beings as Miles Clark Kent, news reporter for the Daily Planet. When we last saw him, Superman was on the trail of the Gyptonelli gang, petty racketeers, who had escaped from town after capturing Lois Lane, feature writer for the Daily Planet. While Superman, in his character of Clark Kent, sped northward toward the gang hideout with Editor White and young Jimmy Olsen, a Daily Planet copy boy. Lois made good her escape from Donnelly's cabin in the deep woods, taking with her the evidence of Donnelly's guilt, but only to run into an even greater danger. In leaving the cabin to follow her, Donnelly and his henchman Spike accidentally knocked over a kerosene stove, and at once the flimsy wooden shack was a mass of fire. Donnelly and Spike raced for their car, leaving Lois to her fate, while tongues of flame licked hungrily toward the dry wood. As our story continues today, the racketeers are several miles from the burning cabin, headed back to the city, speeding over the rough road in their powerful black sedan. Listen.
Listen, Spike. You sure that Lane girl took the briefcase with her?
Well, you looked for it yourself, didn't you?
Yeah, it wasn't anywhere in that room.
What difference does it make? If it's gone, it's gone, ain't it?
Yeah, if it's gone. If it ain't, it can make a lot of difference.
How?
What's the matter? You that dumb? There's papers in that briefcase. And them papers tell all about our collections back in town. Who we tapped and for how much.
What if somebody finds it, Chip?
I'm counting on the fire to fix those papers for good.
Yeah, but what if somebody gets in there to put out the fire?
Don't worry. They got a fine chance of doing that.
Why not?
For two reasons, Spike. Number one, in another 20 minutes, the woods will be like a furnace. Number two, the road's blocked.
Oh, that's what you was doing while I get out the car.
If anybody takes the road back to that cabin, Spike, they'll find a big tree down, right in their way.
Yeah?
And if they try to move the tree, well, it'll be the last thing they ever do move. I can tell you that.
Honest? How come?
Never mind how come. Just believe what I'm telling you. Quite a while ago, I figured on something like this happening.
I'd say that you figure all the angles, Chip.
I'll say I do.
What's up
now?
It's a blowout. It's this washboard road. Pull up, Chip.
Yeah, right front shoe. We got a spare?
Sure, we got a spare. Wait till I get the trunk open.
There ain't no time to get held up. How long will it take?
Oh, 15 minutes, maybe more.
Step on it, will you? Hey, wait.
What's the matter?
There's a car coming up the road. Keep low.
What if they stop?
No, they won't stop.
Hey, Donnelly, they're slowing down. They're stopping.
Keep quiet. I'll handle this.
Hey there, you fella. You know this road?
Spike, roll a big collar and keep your head down. Yeah. What do you want to know?
How far is it to Little Fall?
5 miles. You can't miss it.
Okay. Watch your bike.
All right.
Gee, what's that luck?
What do you mean, luck? See the guy in the front seat next to the driver?
No, what of it?
I ain't sure, but I think it was that newspaper guy. What's his name?
Clark Kent?
Yeah. He didn't open his trap, but I bet it was him, all right. And didn't I see a kid in the back seat?
Yeah, there was a kid in there.
I don't know who the old guy driving was, but if I'm right and the other fellow was Kent, well, it's a cinch the kid was young Olsen.
Gee, well, what are they doing up here?
After the Lane girl, of course. And she's out somewhere in those woods with a fire getting closer every minute. Well, come on. Don't stand there gaping. Get a move on.
What are we going to do?
Fix this flat. That's the first thing. Then I'm going to turn right around and head back to Little Falls.
What? After them?
You said it. It's too good a chance. We might get to knock them all off at once. And who'd be left to tell about the racket then? Come on. Get hot with them, too.
Falls yet?
Pretty near, Jimmy. Was it 5 miles that fella said, Mr. White?
That's right, Kent. We've covered about 4 of them already. What's troubling me now is how we're going to locate Denali's hideout when we get there. All we know so far is that it's somewhere in Little Falls or near it.
Look, Mr. White, isn't that a gas station up ahead?
Yeah, we'll pull in. That's as good a place as any to ask questions.
All right. We're almost out of gas anyway.
There's a man inside. He's coming out now.
Evening, gentlemen. Fill her up.
You might as well. We don't know just how far we're going.
Say, Little Falls anywhere around here?
Yes, sir. Sure it is. Just about a mile down the road. Keep right at the forks.
Forks, mister?
Yep. Left hand goes into the woods. Go in there and you stand a mighty good chance of getting stuck.
Stuck? Why?
Probably muddy.
Oh, no, it ain't mud. It's just a mighty narrow, mean road that's blocked. Big tree down across it.
How do you know?
Well, a couple of city fellas went by heading for the city a while ago, and they
that's
told
funny.
Me.
I wonder how they knew.
Well, they got a cabin in there.
Look here. These two men, they didn't by any chance come up from the city about 4 or 5 hours ago, did they?
Why, gee, mister, you must be a mind reader.
What?
And you're dead right. They did go through just about 4 or 5 hours ago. Only there were three of them then. I know because they stopped for cigarettes.
Three of them. Kent, do you hear that?
Listen, was the third person in that car a girl?
Oh, now, quit your kidding. They're friends of yours. You knew them all the time.
Was the third person a girl?
Was it?
She was.
And they drove back just now without her?
Yep. Guess they parked her in the cabin. Maybe they're coming back. Hey, where you going?
Where's your phone? Quick.
I ain't got no phone.
Come back here, Kent.
Look here. That was Dinelli on the road. That man you stopped to ask directions of. And he's left Lois up in that cabin. We've got to get her out and warn the police.
Hey, listen, I don't know what you're talking
about. Never mind, you'll find out later.
Hey, listen, wherever it is, you can't get in that cabin. I tell you the road's blocked.
That's right, Mr. White, we forgot.
Confound it.
Mr. White, look here. We've got to separate.
What do you mean, Ken?
You take the car, get to the nearest phone. Where is it, mister?
Well, now, let's see. Down at Robbins, third house on the left.
All right, you phone the police, Mr. White. Tell them to watch all roads back to the city.
Well, Ken, what are you going to do?
I'm going up the road into the woods. Even if a car can't get through, maybe a man can.
I'll go with you, Mr. Kent.
No, you stay here, Jimmy.
I'll take him with me.
No, he'd better stay right here, Mr. White.
What's the idea?
Jimmy, you watch the road. Keep your eye out for Dinelli's car, just in case he takes it into his head to come back again.
Mr. Kent, what do I do if he does come?
Let's see. Hey, you. Have you got a gun?
Sure, I got a gun. Only I ain't going to let
Never
you
mind know. That. Those two men who own that cabin are crooks and racketeers.
What's that?
You heard me. Now, if that car comes back again while I'm up the road toward the camp, fire your gun 3 times. Get it?
I get it, Mr. Kent. So long, Mr. White.
Oh, Kent, when I've made that phone call, I'll come right back.
So will I, Mr. White. Meanwhile, I'll see if that tree can be cleared off the road.
I'll hurry all I can.
Now then, I'll run a few steps to get out of sight. Oh, poor Lois. If they're holding her in that cabin, but not for long.
Well, we know where she is. All right, this ought to do it. They can't see me from the gas station. If I know anything at all, Dinelli's blocked the road on purpose. But he can't block Superman. Up! Up!
Leaping into the air, Superman streaked over the darkness of the pine woods, following the dim ribbon of the dirt road below. An odor of smoke is in the night wind, but he pays no heed to that. On through the darkness, then sharply down toward the impassable barrier of a huge fallen tree, blocking off all entrance to the cabin.
There. What's that? Looks like a tree. It is. Down right across the road. Well, shouldn't take us too long to get rid of that. Down. Down. Now then, a little hard to get at. The working coat upon the trunk. Full-grown pine, 70 feet long if it's an inch and 3 feet thick. Must weigh 8 or 9 tons. Well, I wonder how far I can throw this tree, like hurling a javelin. What's this? It's a wire. This thing's wired down. That's funny. Well, score one for Dinelli. Wired that tree to a blasting charge. Blew up right in my face. Anybody else would have been shattered to bits. Good thing dynamite can't hurt me. But maybe it wasn't so good for Dinelli. That blast blew the tree right off the road. If I can't get to the cabin now, I... 3 shots. That means trouble back at the gas station. Something's happened. Here comes a car. Can't be Dinelli. They never make a row like that. Must be the police. Well, whoever it is, all they'll find when they get here is Clark Kent.
Come to think of it, I'd better go to meet them. Just in case Dinelli's planted any more surprises.
Hey, hold it!
What's the matter?
Kent, great Scott, man. Sun explosion.
Mr. White, how did you hear it? How did you get here?
Well, I was on the way back after making the phone call. What happened?
Dinelli's gang left a charge of blasting powder under the fallen tree. It just went off.
And are you all right? Is Jimmy all right?
Jimmy. Jimmy's back at the gas station.
No, he's not. The man said he went after you.
But he didn't. I told him to stay there.
I know what you told him. But the man said he followed you anyway. If he was in that blast...
Mr. White, it's not possible. I would have seen him.
He must be in the woods.
Jimmy! Jimmy Olsen!
Jimmy!
Where are you? Jimmy! Jimmy Olsen! Jimmy, where are you? Jimmy?
Frantic shouts and calls go off into the darkness of the forest, and only mocking echoes come faintly back. Jimmy has vanished in the wood. And meanwhile, stronger and stronger on the night wind, the odor of burning brush comes drifting from the direction of the cabin. Jimmy is gone. Lois is gone. And somewhere behind, creeping up through the night, Dinelli and Spike are returning to see what Kent and White have found. The thrilling climax is not far off. Tune in next time and follow the exciting, thrill-packed story of Superman.
Up in the sky! Look! It's a bird!
It's a plane!
It's Superman!
Superman is a copyrighted feature appearing in Action Comics magazine.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman.
Up in the sky, look, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman.
And now, Superman, champion of the weak and the oppressed, valiant fighter for truth and justice, who has appeared on Earth with the strength of a locomotive and the speed of an airplane, and with a physical structure never before attained by mortal men. Superman, who walks the earth and goes about among human beings, is Miles Clark Kent, news reporter for the Daily Planet. When we last saw him, Kent was standing in the darkness of a pine forest above the town of Little Falls, with Editor White of the Planet calling vainly for young Jimmy Olsen, suddenly lost in the night. Also missing was Lois Lane, feature writer, who had been carried off by Gyp Dinelli's gang of racketeers and brought north to the woods. Lois had made her escape as an overturned stove set fire to the gangster's cabin and started a roaring blaze in the surrounding woods. But so far, she has not been found. As our story continues today, Clark Kent and Editor White are standing where we left them, on the road to Dinelli's cabin, listening to someone crashing toward them through the woods.
Kent, it's the fellow from the gas station.
Hey there! Quick, will you? Have you found the boy?
No, not yet. You fellas got any line on him up this way?
Not a thing. Why didn't you keep him with you at the station?
Heck, he ain't my boy, mister. He said he was going, and that was that.
What was he trying to do?
Well, near as I could make out, he wanted to find that gal you said was in the cabin.
How in heaven's name did he think he could do that?
Well, he said he'd been a Boy Scout or something, knew his way in the woods, and I sure hope he's right.
Why, what do you mean?
Listen, mister, can't you smell?
Smell? Mr. White, it's smoke. Yep. That's what was making you cough.
Smoke is right, and there's more of it all the time. If you ask me, there's a brush fire smoldering in the woods.
Brush fire? Kent, what are we going to do?
Mr. White, Jimmy and Lois, we've got to find them and get them out of there.
Kent, I know it, but how?
Yeah, and the longer we wait, the harder it's going to get. Kid's gone so far, he can't hear us. And no telling where he'll be if that fire really breaks out.
Look here, which way? When he left the station, which way did he head?
Well, mister, I can't even tell you that. He waited till my back was turned and lit out.
Yeah?
When I came back, he was gone. Listen, you take my advice and get out while you can. When this plane starts to go...
What do you want us to do? Leave the boy in the woods?
Oh, we've got to find them, both of them. Jimmy!
Lord! Oh, that ain't going to do you no good, I'm telling you. That fire breaks loose, it'll be bad. The wind's coming up, too.
Don't stand there talking, man. We've got to find them. Come on.
Jimmy!
Jimmy!
Lord! Lord, play! Jimmy!
Recklessly making their way toward the heart of the burning woods, the hollow cries of the rescue party die off in the distance. Almost at once, two dark forms appear in the shadowy roadway. Gyp Dinelli and his follower, Spike, hiding in the darkness, have overheard every word. Dinelli emerges from the trees and calls softly.
Spike. Spike, you there?
Yeah, right here, boss.
You've been here a long time. Listen, you know where the kid is?
Not me. I guess he just did what they said.
Is that a break for us?
What do you mean?
Listen, I don't know why that fire holds back so long. But it's due to bust any minute now.
Yeah, so what are we sticking around for?
Just to make sure, that's all.
Sure of what?
Something called a pack fire. It burns out in front of the first fire. When we get that far, they both go out, see? But there ain't anything more to burn.
So what?
So that's what we're going to do right now. We're good citizens, ain't we?
You ought to know.
And good citizens help stop fires. Come on, Spike. Give me a hand here. The wind's just right, too.
Right for what?
For what we're going to do. We're going to start a backfire, Spike. Right here. So it'll carry straight into the woods. Is it our fault if somebody happens to get caught in between? Break up some of that brush. Fast.
All unknowing of the peril behind them, Kent and the rescue party head toward the center of the woods, the smoke growing thicker at every step and occasional sparks drifting by in the night wind. While farther off, just beyond earshot, young Jimmy Olsen stumbles between tall pines, calling desperately for Lois. Suddenly, slightly ahead, he hears an answering cry.
The plane! The plane, where are you?
Here! Here! Who's that calling?
The plane, it's me. It's Jimmy Olsen. Where are you?
Here, Jimmy. Here, this way.
The plane. Gosh, is that you?
Oh, Jimmy. Jimmy, I can't believe.
Gee, we've been looking all over for you, Miss Lane.
Where in the world did you come from?
We came up in a car, me and Mr. Kent and Mr. White. You haven't seen them any place, have you?
Jimmy, I haven't seen anybody since I got away. That man, Benelli, had me tied up in the shack, and I got out.
What's the briefcase you got there, Miss Lane?
Oh, I don't know. It has papers and things, proof of what they've been doing. If we ever get out of here, Jimmy, this briefcase ought to send them all to jail.
If we ever get out of here? Golly, Miss Lane, what are you talking about? We're getting out of here right now.
Oh, Jimmy, we can't. At least I can't. I twisted my ankle, and the fire's coming.
What's coming?
The woods. The woods are on fire, Jimmy. It started right after I got away from the cabin and it spread to the woods.
Oh, gee, let's get going. Come on.
Jimmy, I can't. I can hardly walk. But you go. You get out while you can. Go on.
What? And leave you here? Not a chance, Miss Lane. Here, you grab my shoulder.
Oh, Jimmy. Jimmy, I can't do it.
Miss Lane, you gotta do it. You don't want to stay here and get burned up, do you? Come on. Look, over there, just beyond that little ridge.
Oh, Jimmy. Jimmy!
It's the fire. It's coming right this way and fast, too. Listen, get up on your feet. Come on. We got to make a run for it.
Jimmy, go on. Don't wait for me.
No, come on. Grab hold of me. Now, this way. Back where I came from. Come on, Miss Lane.
Oh, Jimmy, my ankle. Oh, I can't make it.
Thicker and thicker grows the smoke. More and more fiery sparks. A sheet of flame lights up the woods when suddenly the blue-clad figure of Superman soars high in the blazing forest. If anybody's going to get out of this place alive, including Jimmy and Lois Lane, Superman has to take a hand. Up! Up! I've got to get down there where the fire's hottest and beat it out. After that, maybe I can find Lois and Jimmy. It's got to be fast. Those flames are gaining every minute. Closing in. Ah, there. That looks like a good place. If I can break through there. Down! Down! Now then. Right in the middle of the flames. Good thing I don't mind heat. If I can just snatch up a pine tree and use it like a broom. Let's see now. There, that looks like a good one. Sort of do it. Nothing like sweeping up a forest fire with a 50-foot tree. I can just open up a way out through here. There, a fire lane. Not much time. Here we go. Hot. Hotter than a blast furnace. I'm gaining some. Now, just a few more good ones.
Come on. We need to make another call. We're almost out now. We must be almost out. Jimmy, it's no use. We simply can't make it. We're trapped.
No. No, we're not. Don't say that, Miss Lane. Don't even think it. We've got to keep going.
Jimmy, it was good of you to say. You could have gotten out if you'd gone when I told you. Maybe you still can. Try it, Jimmy. Please.
No, we'll both get out.
Not that way, Jimmy. The fire is coming closer.
Back, we'll go back.
No, we can't go that way either. It's all around us. Jimmy, we're hemmed in. Look, it's creeping up on us.
Miss Lane, the smoke. I can't see.
Neither can I. Oh, Jimmy.
Jimmy Olsen, Miss Lane.
Listen, somebody's calling.
Jimmy, Miss Lane, both of you, this way, quick.
Who is it? I can't see.
I can't either. I can't see a thing. But it sounds like Mr. Kent.
It is. Come on, both of you, quick.
Mr. Kent, I can't see. The smoke.
Here, catch hold of my hand. You too, Miss Lane. Now, we'll make a run for it. Quick.
Say, Mr. Kent, what's going on? I'm not touching the ground at all.
Mr. Kent, what's happening?
Come on. I'm carrying you both. Don't stop to ask questions. Now, here comes the hot spot. Hold your breath. We're almost out. Here we go.
Oh, that's a lot.
We're out. Now, here's the road. Now, where's Kent? Kent!
He must be along. He was right behind us. Oh, say, if we hadn't found that place where the fire was beat out.
You're lucky. Luckiest thing I ever saw. But where's Kent?
Hey. Hey, here he comes now. Through the smoke. Hey, mister.
Oh, look. Look.
He's got two people with him. Say, it's the kid and the girl. He's got them both.
Kent. Kent.
Oh, glad to see you got out, Mr. White. Look what I found.
Oh, Mr. White. Oh, thank
heaven. Mr. White, is that you? See, I can't see anything.
The smoke, it's still in my eyes.
You'll be all right.
No, Kent, I can't believe it. You mean to tell me you found them and brought them out?
Gee, sure did. Both of us.
It was like a dream. I thought I was flying.
I don't wonder. We made time, all right. But look here. Where's the car? We're not out of the woods yet.
I'll say we're not.
Well, the car's this way. Right down the road. Come on, hurry.
All right. Come on, you two. Here, let me give you a hand, Miss Lane. Or Jimmy and I'll make a chair,
you
eh?
You bet, Mr. Kent.
That's the boy. Here we go. Now. There.
Okay, Chip. What are you going to do now?
I still like to know how they got out of that fire.
Well, don't ask me how, but they got out.
No, it ain't going to help much. Take it from me.
Well, Chip, what do you mean?
I got one big surprise left, Spike. Look behind you. See anything in the back seat?
So dark. Oh, wait. Yeah, it looks like a box. Not very big.
No, it's not very big. But, oh, boy, when that little box does its stuff. That guy Kent and all the rest of them will wish they'd passed out in the fire.
What are you going to do?
You'll see. First thing, we've got to get out on the main road a couple of miles ahead of them. Give her the gun. Fast.
What new threat is Dinelli making against the safety of the little group from the Daily Planet? Are they out of the burning woods only to face new and undreamed of dangers? And what strange and incredible climax waits for Clark Kent and his friends on the road from Little Falls? Tune in and don't miss the exciting climax of the next installment of Superman. And remember, be sure to tune in the next thrilling installment of the amazing transcription feature, Superman.
Up in the sky. Look. It's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman.
Superman is a copyrighted feature appearing in Action Comics magazine.
Wheat cereal invites you to rocket into the future with
Tom Corbett, Space Cadet.
Stand by to raise ship. Blast off minus 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
As roaring rockets blast off to distant planets and far-flung stars, we take you to the age of the conquest of space with Tom Corbett, Space Cadet. When a group of interplanetary government scientists working a secret project on the planet Mercury were reported suffering from 0A, a dread disease that attacks men confined to small areas, Tom Corbett and his Space Academy unit mates were dispatched to investigate. There on the airless, forbidding surface of Mercury, they discovered that the scientists had been massacred by savage killers who used monstrous metal radio-controlled robots to accomplish their bloody end. And only great courage and skill enabled Tom and his friends to defeat the metal giants. As we join them now in the Polaris, Tom watches as Roger Manning straps on a body jet, preparing to join Astro, who has left to guard the grounded robots some distance away.
Hey, Roger, just what are you and Astro planning to do with that kit of tools and equipment?
Look, Tom, I've told you 8 million times. We're just going to examine the robots.
Examine them or tinker with them? Remember, those things are dangerous.
Correction, Junior. They were dangerous.
Okay, go ahead. But watch out for trouble. Remember that the killers who sent the robots after us may try to get them back.
Space dust. You know what's wrong with you, Junior? This gloomy twilight zone is giving you the jitters.
Think so? All right, little boy. Run and play if you like, but remember, although you think of Mercury as just a big playground, it may still turn out to be a battleground. Space Academy cruiser Polaris calling Venusport Station. Come in, Venus. Polaris to Venus. Come in, please. Blast it. Why don't they answer? Is that you, Roger? Hey, you're not Roger, or...
No, Cadet Robert. We're neither Roger nor Astro. The spacesuits confuse you. But then that kind of confusion is quite normal in the type of...
Who are you, and how did you two get in here without setting off the alarm?
There was no alarm. The outer hatch was ajar.
Ajar? I told Roger to be careful.
Now, let's not get excited. Just relax, and everything will be all right.
Relax? Why, you...
Stop, or I'll fire. And drop that wrench.
Oh, a parallel ray gun, huh?
We'd have to use it on you, but...
I know. You'd rather have one of your robots smash me to bits, wouldn't you? All right, you're 2-1, and you've got me. Now what?
Leslie, take off your helmet, will you? That should convince our young friend of something.
Don't bother. I wouldn't expect a dirty space crawler like you to... Great. Jumping Jupiter.
Hello, Cadet Corbett.
A girl in your color and uniform.
Yes. I'm Leslie Everett of the Solar Guard Nurse Corps.
A nurse? But what in the universe?
And this is Dr. Ashton.
Commander Burke sent us here from Venus to help you.
But I don't get this. Where's the guard cruiser? The man weapons?
There is no cruiser. A freighter dropped us off in a jet boat.
And as for weapons, well, we hardly need those, do we? Except for my little ray gun here. And that's just to calm down anyone who becomes too, excitable.
Well, now I understand why they acted so funny when they said help was coming. Everyone thought I was just raving with 0A fever.
Poor boy, it must have been terrible for you.
Yes, but things will be fine now. Dreadful as 0A is, the cure is not difficult. I've had a good deal of experience with space psychoses.
Forgive me, Doctor, but I don't care if you've had experience with space fever. We need fighting men here, not medics.
We mustn't be violent. Just relax.
All right, I'm sorry, Doc. It's not your fault, but please get this straight. I'm not crazy. It's all true. Everything I reported to Venus Station is true.
You mean huge flying robots and a group of killers operating under my remote control?
Yes!
Well, we won't argue about it. But now, if you'll just roll...
Great galaxy, what do I have to do to convince you?
Tom!
What's the matter, nurse?
Doctor, I'm afraid I've gone 0A, too.
That's ridiculous, Leslie.
Then look out the viewport there.
Flying monsters.
Those are robots.
And they're diving right at this ship.
We'll return to the exciting adventures of Tom Corbett, Space Cadet, in just a moment, so stand by.
Spaceman, you know, Tom Corbett says Kellogg's Pep is the best cereal he ever tasted. And Astro says he eats more Pep than anybody else at Space Academy. But this is even better. You know, the other day I was out on the spaceport landing strip, and even Roger Manning was talking about Pep. Well, he's a pretty hard man to please.
You know, you get thinking out here on the landing strip. Takes a lot of power to send a ship blasting off into space. There goes the Hydra. In a way, people need the right fuel just like a rocket ship. If you want to blast off with lots of drive and action in the morning... You have to put away some energy food like Kellogg's Pep. Pep gives you a good supply of food energy. Vitamins, too, like vitamin B1 and D. Something you really need to help keep up strength and vitality. And Kellogg's Pep tastes good, too. It's got the kind of flavor that makes you want an extra bowl full. Say, I think I'll go down to the Academy mess hall and have some Pep right now. And any space monkey that gets in my way... Well, think he's been hit with a flock of meteors. When I want my Pep, I get my Pep. You spacemen listening, smarten up and ask your mom for Kellogg's Pep. You'll like it.
Well, that's just what Roger said, and he's right, too. Open a package of Kellogg's Pep tomorrow morning and pour yourself a heaping bowlful. One spoonful of that malty, rich goodness, and you'll say, just like Roger Manning, the spaceman cereal is Kellogg's Pep. P-E-P. Pep.
Pep.
waiting impatiently for the help promised by the Solar Guard station on Venus, Tom Corbett has found they meant medical help, a doctor and nurse, instead of the men and weapons needed to safeguard the captured robots. As Tom tries to convince Dr. Ashton and Nurse Everett that he is sane and the robots really exist, they suddenly receive dramatic proof when two of the monsters appear and dive straight for the Polaris.
Those monsters, they're going to crash into the ship.
Great galaxy, Corbett. What can we do?
Nothing, but the Polaris should be tough enough to take it.
Suppose they hit up near the nose. They could topple us over.
Well, they might, so hang on.
Wait.
They're not going to ram us. They're landing near the tail.
Can they break into the ship?
Well, not for a while at least, but...
What's that?
What are they doing, Corbett?
What I was afraid of, attacking the vanes and rocket tubes.
Hey, Junior, how's everything in the ship?
Who's that on your radio?
It's Roger. Maybe he and Astro can help. Roger, listen. Two new robots are attacking the ship.
Yeah, no fool.
Look, this is no joke. They're right here and...
Are you sure it's two new robots, Tom?
Well, of course I'm... Wait a minute. Where are you?
Oh, we're around. Cut it out, Roger. Tom, this is Astro. We're behind the rocks just east of the ship, and the robots...
Oh, I get it. They're the ones we captured. You found a way to work them.
That's right.
Oh, thank goodness.
And I thought we'd fly them to the ship without tipping you off first. Some joke, huh, Junior?
Yeah, some joke.
Hey, who was that?
That's Dr. Ashton, Roger. He and a nurse were sent here from Venus. They came because Venus thought we'd gone zero A, and I guess maybe you have.
What's the idea of pulling a crazy stunt like this?
I was just giving you a little scare. I didn't know there was a girl aboard. Besides, there's no need to worry anymore. The killers are gone. They left long ago. We're the robot masters now. So get your spacesuits on. We'll give you all an exhibition of how we can control them. Oh, bring the doctor, too. And especially the nurse.
Goodness, aren't they the big, horrible-looking things?
You don't have to be afraid of the robots while I'm around, nurse. Wait till you see the tricks I can make them do.
The tricks we can make them do, hotshot.
Oh, yeah. Astro helps a little, too.
Oh, I'm sure he does.
A little? Listen, who traced the power connections? And
never mind, Astro. Let him show off for the lady. We'll get through faster and get away from Mercury. We don't have to stay now that we can get the robots aboard.
Oh, right, Junior. Come on, Astro. We'll get set up.
Okay.
I'll be right back, nurse. Don't go away.
I won't.
You know, Corbett, thinking of the robots as machines, not as grotesque humans, they don't seem so ugly.
Well, I don't know.
Oh, Doctor, with six arms and those short, thick legs like a huge hippopotamus?
Well, they're functional. Legs like that can support tremendous weight, and they keep the center of gravity low.
And that's right. And the arms are fitted with heavy claws, durasteel fingers, a drill, and look here, a sort of shovel.
Yes, I see, but you think all those things make them handsome?
Well, no, but they must have been wonderful miners.
Miners? You mean to dig?
Oh, yes, of course. You see, the men who operated them could stay at their base on the twilight zone here on Mercury and send these things out to the hot side.
Right, instead of going out themselves in diggers the way the Solar Alliance men had to do. What's more, I'm afraid they've already found what our men were looking for.
What was that, Cadet Corbett?
I don't know, nurse. You see, the project was top secret.
Hey, everybody, we're ready. Watch this now. Presenting the newest ballroom team, Robert and Roberta Robot.
What in the world? Oh, why, those hideous monsters are dancing.
Perfectly ridiculous. Careful now. Keep them away.
Man, that's right. Watch it. If they fall on us...
Oh, don't worry. They won't. We've got this down to a science.
Well, maybe you have it that. The controls aren't too complicated.
True genius, my boy, is often simple.
Get him.
Isn't it wonderful?
I am. Aren't I?
Surely those tiny hands transmitted of yours can't furnish power for such huge machines.
Oh, they have their own power supply, Doctor. The radio signal just activates it.
Right. Now watch this. Ready, Astro?
Ready.
Up they go!
They're climbing into the sky.
Roger, what's happening?
They're not responding to the controls.
Uh-oh. Look. Look, they're coming down again. Toward us. Stop them. Stop them!
Good heavens, do something!
We can't. Someone must have taken over with stronger transmitters.
The killers. They're still on Mercury.
Look! The robots are diving at us!
Shatter! Head for the Polaris! Run! We made it. Come on, close the hatch.
Just in time. One of them nearly got me if it hadn't been for the light gravity.
Hey, wait. There's only four here. Someone's missing.
The doctor.
No, I'm here. You dragged me in. Look back, Leslie.
Great Jupiter. I thought you were Leslie.
So did I when I saw you grab him.
And she's still out there with those robots.
She must have dodged between the rocks.
Open the hatch again. Hurry.
See anything? Look, the robots. In the air, they're flying away.
Yeah, one of them's carrying something in its arms.
Great
galaxy.
It's the Nest. Leslie, they've got her.
Oh, Astro, get the rockets blasting. We're going after them.
Control deck to power deck.
Loading guy.
Reduce speed 1/4, Astro.
Reduce speed, Tom.
Right, hurry.
What? Okay, reducing speed.
Corbett, what's the matter with you? Don't you want to catch them?
Not yet.
Look, Junior, have you gone space happy?
No, we'll have to wait till they land.
But why? Why? Go after them now, man.
Then what? How do we knock off the robots in flight without killing the nurse?
He's right, Doc.
Good heavens, I hadn't thought. Can't you force them down somehow?
Impossible. Can you think of anything, Roger?
No, unless maybe...
Calling the Polaris. Calling the Polaris. Come in, Polaris.
Who's that?
This is the Polaris. Who are you?
Never mind, sir. Enough for you to know we've regained control of our robots. Your nurse's life is now in your hands. Give up. Surrender now, or you die before your eyes.
Great galaxy.
Rummy space rats.
Tell them we'll surrender, Corbett. We have no choice. We can't let Leslie be killed.
Of course not, but... Well, this maybe is a bluff.
No, Tommy's not bluffing about Leslie. They'll kill her.
Yes, yes, they'll kill her. Look. Look at her held in the steel claws.
We've got to do something, Tom, and fast.
Wait, I've got a brainstorm that might work.
What is it, Tom?
Well, Polaris, you've taken long enough. What's your answer?
Here, Roger, talk to them, but stall. Stall as long as you can. How can we be sure you only want to capture us, that you're telling the truth?
You're trying to waste time. There'll be no more of that. Look at the robot. Unless you surrender now, watch how it drops the girl.
Well, wait just
enough
a minute.
Stalling. Okay, Renson, let her fall.
No, no, wait!
It's all right, Roger. Astro and I fixed it.
Look, she's still safe.
What's the matter? What happened to the robot? Why, those blasted cadets.
Tom, what did you do?
We took control of the robot with our main transmitter at full power. They can't drop her now.
Thank heaven.
Pretty smart thinking, Tom. Look, I'm going to land the robot. Follow it down.
Right. Stand by, Astro.
Standing by.
If you think your little trick is going to save the girl, you're wrong, my friend. You can't steal control of the other robot. We'll do the job with that.
Oh, no.
Is he telling the truth?
I'm afraid he is.
Yes, we only have one transmitter set up.
And the second robot's going down, too.
Roger.
Get the one with Leslie off the ground again. Fast.
I am, but the other one has the edge in speed now. You've got to do something.
Can't you clip the antenna off the way you did with the jet boat?
No, Astro. The Polaris is too big and fast, and if we missed one try, we wouldn't have time for another.
Just plow into it, then. Knock it down.
We can't do that, Doctor. It's too near the ground. We'd crash, too.
But Tom, the way you're diving at it now, we're sure to crash anyhow.
No, I'm going to pull up hard at the last minute. Roger, stand by to send Leslie's robot off at an angle.
Okay, now. Here goes.
Good. Now I'm going to pull out of the dive. Brace yourself.
What good did that do, Corbett? You pulled up when we were still 100 feet from the robot.
That's right, Doctor. But when we went up, the jets and the tail swept right over
us. Well, that they did, Tom. And even those robots weren't built to withstand a blast of white hot heat like that. Look, it's going down out of control.
By Jupiter, you're right.
Fast thinking, Tom. Now I can land the one that's carrying Nurse Leslie, and then we can get her aboard.
Right.
Yes, she'll be safe now, and so will we.
Okay, Polaris, you won that round and destroyed one of our robots. But I promise you we'll win the next round, and that will be the last, because now you'll be destroyed.
Leslie, are you sure you're all right?
Well, I think I will be, Doctor, as soon as I can realize I'm really safe again. It's still a little hard to believe, you know.
I should think so, Nurse, after what you went through.
We should be shocked for letting him catch you in the first place.
Oh, no. It wasn't your fault. You were all wonderful.
Well, yeah, the others were pretty helpful. I would have had much more trouble saving you alone.
Why, you bubblehead.
Easy, Astro. Is there anything we can do to make her more comfortable, Doctor?
No. I'll take care of her, Corbett. You boys had better get that robot aboard, since you feel you can't leave it behind.
Oh, why can't we?
I want the Solar Alliance to have it, not the killers. Astro, get down to the power deck, will you? Stand by to blast off.
Okay, Tom. I'll be ready when you are.
Roger, get on the controls of the robot. I'll open the hatch.
Tom, look!
There's a ship almost over us.
Great galaxy, they found us already.
Who is that?
The same men who tried to kill me?
Yes, they said they'd destroy us all.
Man, you waited, Cadet, because we have a little present for you. And here it is.
They're firing an atomic warhead.
Down, everybody, down! Are you all okay?
Yeah. You all right, Leslie?
Yeah, but that was so close.
We're lucky it wasn't closer.
We have to get off the ground, Corbett, quickly.
We sure do.
Control the power deck. Blast off, Astro, now.
I can't, Tom. The power tubes are damaged. I'm afraid we're stuck here for good.
We'll return to the exciting adventures of Tom Corbett, Space Cadet, in just a moment. So, stand by. Spaceman, you've been with Tom Corbett on flights through space. You've been with him on Mars and Venus. You've seen him in action at Space Academy, too. Well, now you can get Tom Corbett's picture on a magic moving picture eye. The magic eye is a plastic disc with Tom's picture in it. When you tilt it back and forth, the picture inside shows you exciting action. And besides Tom Corbett, there are other action pictures, too. One magic eye shows Bobby Riggs, famous tennis star. Another shows a Douglas Skyrocket jet plane. And you can get as many as 16 different magic eye subjects. Planes, movie stars, trains, sports stars. And listen to this. You don't have to write in to get a magic eye. No, sir. No box tops, no waiting, nothing extra to pay. You get a magic eye free at no extra cost. Every time you get a package of Kellogg's Pep. Now, think of it. There's a magic eye waiting for you inside every package of Kellogg's Pep. Get some magic eyes right away. Sew them on your jacket or belt. They really look swell. And the more you get, the better. So let's get going, spaceman. Remember, there's a magic eye free at no extra cost in each and every package of the Build-Up Wheat Cereal Kellogg's Pep. P-E-P. After rescuing Nurse Leslie, Tom, Roger, and Astro moved swiftly to get the captured robot aboard and blast off from Mercury before the enraged killers could find them. But suddenly a ship appeared overhead and fired an atomic warhead which crippled the Polaris, making escape impossible. Now as the killer ship turns to make another bomb run, there appears to be no way to stop the attack which their enemy has promised will blow them to space dust.
Isn't there anything we can do to avoid being hit again?
We must do something.
I don't see what... Yes, there's something. We can try it at least. The robot. Send it up, Roger.
Oh, what good will a robot do?
It isn't fast enough to catch a ship.
It doesn't have to. The ship is coming to us. The robot only has to intercept. Now, if it's still working...
It is working, Tom. There it goes.
Look, Junior, what are you expecting?
No time to explain now, Roger. Just watch.
Look. Look, they're going to crash. Tom's done it.
No, they're not. They're clear. They're passing above it.
That's just what I wanted. Now their firing rocket tube is exposed.
What? Oh, great Jupiter, if only you can do it.
Do what, for heaven's sake?
Steady, Tom. Steady. There, you've done it.
Look, Doctor. Their ship, it blew up.
But how could it? What happened?
You tell him, Roger.
Well, Tom sent the robot smack into their firing tube. Their own warhead blasted them.
A brilliant maneuver. Brilliant. And now, Leslie, this time we're really safe. Thanks to the quick thinking and steady hand of Cadet Corbett.
You find any more of their gang in the wreckage, Tom?
Yes, four of them, Leslie. But all very dead.
The craters of Luna. I don't see how the leader ever came through alive.
Neither can I.
Can we talk to him, Doctor?
Yes, go ahead. Aside from a few bruises, he's perfectly all right. Amazing luck.
I don't know, Doc. You live to stand trial. That's not so lucky.
Don't worry, you good citizens of the Solar Alliance. You'll never put me on trial.
Get him. Sounds as if he thinks he can escape.
Look here. Just what were you doing on Mercury?
What were you using the robots for?
Mining what your stupid scientists were looking for on their top secret project. Natural plutonium.
Natural plutonium? But that's very rare. Most of it is made artificially.
On Earth, yes, but we found it here. It meant cheap atomic power. Wealth.
Good thing we stopped you. Guys like you don't deserve wealth. You don't know how to use power.
You can stow the speeches, Cadet. I'm not interested.
Hey, I wonder if this gang wasn't just part of a larger outfit.
If so, the Solar Guard will find it and take care of it. Well, we've nothing to do now until the release ship comes. So, let's relax.
Don't miss the next action-packed adventure with Tom Corbett, Space Cadet, when the cadets begin a dangerous masquerade and rocket into the atmosphere of death. Tune in same time, same station on Tuesday for the next thrilling interplanetary adventure with Tom Corbett, Space Cadet. Brought to you by Kellogg's Pep, the build-up wheat cereal. Tom Corbett, Space Cadet, starring Frankie Thomas, can also be seen on television and appears in the comic sections of many of America's leading newspapers. Look for it daily and in weekend editions. Featured in today's cast were Jan Merlin, Al Markham, James Monks, and Connie Lemke. Today's program was written by Don Hughes, directed by Drex Hines. Jackson Beck speaking.
Kellogg's Raisin Bran has a secret. Kellogg's Raisin Bran has a secret.
And what a secret! In Kellogg's Raisin Bran, the tasty raisins are dipped in honeycomb. That means plumper, more tender raisins, along with delicious golden crisp bran flakes. Both fruit and cereal, all in one box. And no other raisin bran but Kellogg's gives you the tender goodness of raisins dipped in honeycomb. That's Kellogg's secret. So for your breakfast, make sure you get Kellogg's, because
Kellogg's Raisin Bran has a secret.
By the way, boys and girls, there's a swell story about Tom Corbett, the cadets, Captain Strong, Dr. Joan Dale, and Commander Arkwright in the new April issue of Radio Television Mirror magazine that just went on sale at your newsstand. You'll enjoy seeing pictures of all the cast at home in the Radio TV Mirror story.
This program has come to you from New...
Getting impatient for baseball season to start? Have a touch of spring fever? Want to get away from it all? We offer you Escape.
You are in mid-ocean, aboard a jinx ship. Already 9 men have died, and you know that some malignant force is aimed at you from which you cannot escape.
Escape, designed to free you from the four walls of today for a half hour of high adventure.
Tonight, we escape from the North Atlantic in the year 1900 and to a sailing ship whose very name struck dread in sailors' hearts. As Joseph Conrad told it in his famous story, The Brute.
Looking at her, proud and strong and beautiful on the outside. You couldn't see the black heart inside of her. And you'd never know she'd killed at least a dozen men and maybe more. Well, I knew her. Knew her for the murdering she-devil she was. I saw her the day she killed her first one. And I was there, too, when she finally made a big mistake and killed the wrong person. But that was a long time later. Well, she had a name, all right. But after that first day, her first killing,
Nobody but the family ever used it again. Everyone else from that day on would look at her half afraid, half snarling, and they called her the Brute. I remember I was 14 the day my father took me down to the South Thames boatyard to watch the launching of the ship. My brother Charlie was there, of course, 8 years older than me and very proud of his one gold stripe now that he'd be made an officer on the Apps line. Charlie and father were talking. I just stood and listened to them and didn't say much of anything myself.
Look at her, Dad. Ever see a ship in your life with lines like that? I bet she'll outsail any clipper in the China trade.
Well, that remains to be seen, Charlie. How soon are they going to launch her?
Any minute now. Oh, I'd give a lot to be sailing on her, instead of on the Malcolm Apps.
Well, the Malcolm's a good ship, son. As good a ship as any of the Apps family own.
So I'm not kicking. I'm glad enough to be through apprenticeship and get my commission. But even at that, I'd almost rather be a bosun on this ship than third mate on the Malcolm.
I understand that Colchester's to be her captain.
Yes, that's right. Oldest commander with the absent son's line. Look at the size of her, Dad. She's a full 2,000 tons.
Less half a ton, Charlie. Oh, good morning, Mr. Jermyn.
Hey, Mr. Wilmot. Hello, Ned.
How do you do, sir?
No, Charlie, she came to 1,999 and a half when we measured
her up. Well, 2,000 tons or not, Mr. Jermyn. You'll never build a better ship than this one.
I don't know, Charlie. I built her the way Mr. Ops once did. She's big and she's stout, but I don't know.
And what's your reason for saying that, sir?
No reason that makes any sense. About the devil's own time with her. Cabin doors jamming when they shouldn't. Edge covers that wouldn't fit after they'd been measured up. Blocks fouling for no reason at all. I don't know, Mr. Wilmot. But if she were a human being, I'd say that maybe she's insane.
Oh, come now. You've been working too hard, Mr. Jermyn. Better take a vacation now that she's finished.
Well, I could certainly use...
I say, that's Maggie Colchester up there, the captain's niece. Is she going to do the christening?
That's right, Charlie. And I'd better get down below now. My own men are going to knock the stays loose and let her slide down into the water.
Well, good luck, Mr. Jermyn.
Thanks, Mr. Wilmot. Come on board for the celebration after she's launched. Bring the boy.
Fine, thank you. We should be there.
They'll let it go any minute now. Dad, I'm going to sail on that ship someday.
Oh, you'll probably sail on a lot of Apps line ships before you're through, Charlie.
Look. Look, they're giving Maggie the champagne now, and she's going to Christmas.
Yes, listen.
I christen thee the Apps family.
The Apps family. So that's what they're naming it, eh?
All right, Pink. Knock out the stairs. Let her go.
Look, Dad, she's starting to move. There she goes.
Yes, well, look at that speed. I never saw it. German, look out!
Good Lord, he fell right into the waves and she went over him.
He didn't fall. A timber rolled off the deck and knocked him under.
She slid right over him. Mr. German, the man who built her.
Well, launched in blood, if that means anything. She's a brute and a murderess now, Charlie. Still think you'd like to sail on her?
It was an accident. It doesn't mean anything.
Perhaps not.
I'll sail on her someday, sooner or later. I will sail on her.
Well, the way things worked out, I was the one to sail on her first, instead of Charlie. He'd gone on out to the Orient aboard a Malcolm. 6 months later, when I started my apprenticeship, I found the company had assigned me to report to Captain Colchester on the Apps family, or the Brute, as everybody was calling it privately. Some kind of mix-up in the sailing orders, and by the time I came on board, a tug already had a line on the big sailing ship and was starting to ease her stern first out into the channel.
All right now, ease ahead there. Pick up the slack.
Captain Colchester was at the taffrail shouting orders to the tug captain, and the mates were forward somewhere, handling the check line.
You've got the slack now. Haul away.
I stood at the waist, waiting for a chance to report in, and watching a young fellow about my own age, who was doing something or other up aloft on the mizzenmast above me. The tug had drawn the line out taut, but the ship hadn't started to move yet.
You've got no way on her yet. Turn your engine up to full speed.
The tug was churning the water to froth, and the hawser was tight as a bowsprit, but we still didn't move.
Keep her up! All that at once, the battle!
Then suddenly the ship gave a lurch and started back like a bucking horse. The men forward had no chance to ease the check cable, and a second later it snapped. The
The ship plunged on deck and then sheered over, coming up with a smash against the pierhead that knocked me sprawling on the deck. And at that moment... the lad who'd been working aloft on the mast crashed down onto the deck not 10 feet away from me. And he lay there without moving.
Give a hand up here on my waist, mate. Young Hawkins just fell out of the tops.
Hey. That's too bad.
Is he dead, Captain Colchester?
He's dead, boy. Get a hold of yourself. Don't stand there trembling. You never seen anybody die before?
Yes, sir. On the day they launched this ship.
Ah, Jermaine, eh? You're young Ned Wilmot, I suppose, the new apprentice.
Yes, sir.
And no doubt you may have heard this ship called by an unpleasant name once in a while.
Yes, sir. The Brute.
Well, you'll be kind enough to remember while you're aboard that her name is the Apps Family, and she's had her share of accidents, the same as any other ship. Is that quite clear?
Yes, sir.
Now get along forward with you and stow your gear away on the forecastle. You'll take over young Hawkins' duties for the time being.
Yes, sir.
I sailed aboard the Brute for the next 4 years and watched her kill 9 men during the time.
We got so we tried to outguess her, try to figure how she'd do it the next time. But no matter what we think, we never were right. And it wasn't only the killing, it was everything. Most ships have little ways all their own, and you'll learn about them and allow for them. Ah, but not her. She was like a crazy woman. You never knew what she'd do next. I remember once off the Gold Coast, she ran before a gale for 2 days as pretty as you please. And then broached to twice the same afternoon. Flung the helmsman clean over the wheel the first time, and the second time swamped herself fore and aft and split out every stitch of canvas. And after we got the decks cleaned up, we found one seaman had gone overboard. He was her fifth, I guess it was. Or maybe the sixth. Oh, she was beautiful, the Apps Family was. Big and proud and beautiful. And along with it, the killer. A black-hearted, sea-going brute. My brother Charlie was on the China Run all that time. First on the Malcolm and later on the Lucy Apps. We never happened to hit port at the same time. Finally, the time of my apprenticeship was up. We boomed into London at the end of the trip, and I went before the board for my papers. I guess they figured anybody who could stay alive for 4 years on the Brute must be a seaman. Anyway, I passed, and Mr. Epps handed me my sailing orders along with the commission. I was assigned as third mate to Captain Colchester on the Epps Family.
Well, congratulations, Ned. Glad you're going to stay with us.
Thanks, Captain Colchester.
You've been a hard-working apprentice, and I've no doubt what you'll be a good officer. In fact, we have a man on board who'll make sure of that.
Why? What do you mean, Captain?
Got a new first mate on this trip. Come in, Charlie.
Charlie?
Well, hello there, youngster. I say, you've been doing a bit of growing in the last 5 years.
Charlie, I didn't even know you were in port.
Been in for a week down country, though. I hear you fooled the board.
Careful, man. You're talking about your own third mate.
Yes, so they tell me. You'll be driving lively on this trip, my boy.
Easy, easy. Don't forget I know this ship and you don't.
And I'll learn it quick enough. Been wanting the chance for a long time. And between us, I think we can even break this jinx.
Lads, there'll be no talk of a jinx on this trip. At least not in the cabin, as long as Maggie's going along.
Maggie? Who's Maggie?
Ask your brother. I think he's the one who talked her into the trip. Though she claims it's for her health. I'll leave you two to get acquainted. We'll be about 10 days loading if you've got any plans.
What's he talking about, Charlie? Who's Maggie?
His niece, Maggie Colchester. You remember her, the girl who christened the ship?
Of course! Ollie,
well,
you're not...
Dad told you where I've been spending shore leaves for the last year and a half?
No, Charlie, I didn't know anything about it.
Well, then let me show you something. Here. Now, if I have my way, Maggie'll be wearing this before the trip's over. Here, take a look.
Blimey. That's all right.
Yes, I bought it in Cape Town. It's a blue-white diamond set in platinum.
Is it big enough to go on a finger?
Oh, it's big enough, all right. And that's where it's going, if I can talk her into it.
And who's going to talk who into what, Charlie?
Maggie, I was, saying that, I hoped I could talk you into going ashore for dinner with me.
Oh, where you now? You big liar.
Oh, Maggie, this is my brother, Ned. Ned, this is Maggie.
How do you do? And are you one of the officers, too?
I'm the new third mate.
Well, I certainly hope you're more truthful than your brother.
Maggie.
Whose invitation to dinner I am accepting with pleasure.
Oh, really?
See you both later.
All right, you are. About an hour.
Charlie, she's lovely.
Yeah, she's more than that, Ned. She's everything as far as I'm concerned.
Well, in that case, good luck. I hope you get her.
Well, we'll see about that. Anyway, with Maggie aboard, we've got to make sure this jinx ship stays on good behavior for once.
Well, it'll be the first time if she does.
Well, it's the first time we've had both the Wilmots on board together. We'll tame her down, Ned. We'll make her calm and peaceful as an old workhorse. Just you wait and see if we don't.
And the strange part of it was, he was right. We stood out past Gravesend and made the passage to the China coast in 121 days of the finest weather you could ever hope to meet. And for the first time in her bloody life, the old ship settled down and sailed herself as neat as you please. Charlie and I would talk about it sometimes when Maggie wasn't around. He'd always laugh and say the brute knew when she'd met her match that she didn't dare try to buck the two of us. But I was more ready to give the credit to Maggie. To think maybe she'd charm the old murderess the way she'd charmed all the rest of us. From the second day out, Maggie was the secret darling of every man on board. She was all over the ship, here, there, and everywhere, with red tam and her bright blue eyes, never still a minute, and having the time of her life. If she'd come along for her help, she'd found it before we passed Gravesend. Raised a storm on the passage back and ran 4 days in a heavy gale. I stood by and held my breath, ready for anything, and nothing happened. The old lady, Epps' family, held up her head and sailed along like a seagull. Any time before, she'd have buried her gunwale in the quartering seas, but now, all the water she shipped, you could put in a teacup. 109 days from Hong Kong, we raised the Dungness light, and early the next morning, picked up a tug off Sheerness for the long tow upriver to London. The ship followed along on the tow line like a puppy on a leash, and we moved slowly up the river past Gravesend. All of us were glad to be home, but Maggie, most of all, I think, because she'd never been at sea so long before. I had to smile at the way she danced around in the bows, picking out one landmark after another as we came to them, sometimes standing up on the spare anchor we'd taken in.
What's wrong, Ned? A tug stopped her engine.
Collision up ahead in the channel, Charlie. Looks like a yawl and a schooner fouled together.
Oh, yes. Well, looks like they're clearing it up now. Guess we can move again in a couple of minutes. Maggie, why don't you go onto the after deck? You're on the way up forward there.
Oh, I'm all right, Charlie. Stop worrying. We're almost home.
Better save your orders for the crew, Charlie. She outranks you.
Oh, I'll take orders from her any day. Yes. We are almost home, Ned. We've had a lucky voyage.
It's the first halfway peaceful trip I've ever made in the old brute.
Oh, I told you we'd tame her down. She's turned over a new leaf, Ned.
Well, it won't last long if she keeps on shearing off there and drifting back down the channel.
Huh? Oh, yes. We're heading straight for those fishing smacks.
Better have the tug start off and hold a taut line on her. I've seen her do this before.
Yes.
Ahoy the tug! Take up the slack and get her straight in the channel. Hold it against the current.
Any other ship would have held steady for the 2 or 3 minutes we'd stopped, but not the old Epps family. And now when the tug tightened up in the hawser, pulling at an angle across her bows, she wouldn't respond, wouldn't budge. The old girl wanted her own way. She was just as stubborn as ever.
Ahoy, the tug! We're still drifting. Up and up to full speed.
Confound her. Never saw a ship act like this.
against the heavy hawse that was pulled so tight it was humming, and tugs paddled with her engines full whipped up the water like a mill race. And then it happened. The heavy towing chock tore loose from the deck. The hawser began sliding across the bow, ripping out rail stanchions like matchsticks. Then the hawser was going to sweep under the roof of the spare anchor, the anchor that Maggie was standing on.
Maggie! Get off that anchor! Look out!
She tried to jump clear, but she was too late. The great anchor had tipped up on its side, clasped her about the waist like a monster's arm of steel. It had carried her with it, and swung down and over and smashed against the side of the ship.
She went into the water. Take charge of the deck, Ned. I'm going in after her.
Ned, was that Maggie?
Yes, sir. She's overboard, Captain Colchester.
Maggie. Oh, the dirty murdering brute. Now it's women she's killing.
Let go the port anchor. All the ship is for years and get the boats over.
I hadn't told Charlie, and I didn't say anything about it to Captain Colchester. But I stood there, and I knew it wasn't any use. Because I'd seen the way the heavy anchor had carried her over, and then swung in to smash her against the bow before it dropped her into the water. And I'd seen the way that water beneath the bow was all colored red. They found her at late afternoon when the tide turned, and she floated clear of one of the mooring buoys. And the next morning, we tied up in the London docks. The men had been happy at coming into their home port, but now they remembered how she'd been happy too, their own darling. I'd never before seen a crew leave a ship so quietly, and some of them, when they reached the wharf, turned back and cursed her under their breath. Finally, it was only Charlie and I, alone on the quarterdeck. Captain Colchester was below somewhere in the cabin.
She never wore it, Ned. The ring. She never wore it.
But she would have, Charlie. I know she meant to. She was just having a little fun with you, that's all.
With all of us on board, why did the brute have to go for Maggie?
Why? I guess there's not much answer for
that. She's everything I wanted. Everything.
Yes, Charlie. I know.
I talked her into making the voyage. It was my idea.
It's no good, Charlie, this kind of thinking. I guess you know that.
I don't know. She's everything I wanted.
Charlie, I...
Over, Stuart.
Over here, Captain.
I'm going ashore. The shipkeeper's come aboard now. The two of you are free to go whenever you like.
Thank you, sir.
Charlie, I... Nothing. I'm resigning command in the morning. I'll never set foot on board her again as long as I live.
I feel the same way, sir.
Well, come into the company office in a day or two and sign out for the log. Good day, gentlemen.
Charlie, we'd better go ashore, too. We're done here.
Yes, I suppose we are.
I'll arrange to have our gear picked up later. There's no use of...
Captain, look out!
Missed him! That yard arm off the mainmast fell right behind him.
Ah, you missed me, you murdering brute. And that was your last chance,
Ned. Ned, that yard was made fast at Dungeness. And now it falls out of the tops with the ship lying still at the wharf.
Yes, Charlie. Come on, let's go ashore.
Wasn't the devil satisfied for one trip? Is there no way of stopping her? How many more does she want to kill?
Charlie.
Oh, Ned. Ned, take me home.
Charlie was 10 years older by the time we reached home, and it was 2 weeks before he'd do anything more than sit in his room and stare at the wall, saying nothing. Captain Colchester carried out his threat and resigned from the company the morning after we docked, and I filed my application for a transfer. The Epps family was reloaded and ready to sail, but she stayed on lying at the wharf with nobody to take her out. And that's the way things stood for 2 weeks until, one morning, a bombshell dropped.
What are you, Ned?
Charlie, I wondered where you went this morning.
And I left the house early.
How do you feel?
Fine. Ned, Mr. Ants tells me you've applied for a transfer. Another ship.
Well, yes, I did, as a matter of fact. You saw Man Apps?
Yes, I stopped in at the office this morning. Ned, it's up to you, of course, but I hope you'll change your mind.
Not a chance.
The ship sails tomorrow morning.
Oh, so they finally found somebody crazy enough to take her out?
Yes, they did. Me.
You? You're going to skip with the brute?
That's right, Ned.
But I
thought... It's a short voyage, North Atlantic run. Be awfully glad to have you along. Somebody I could depend on if you feel like signing on again.
Charlie!
Of course, it's up to you.
All right, Charlie. I'll sign on again. Be glad to.
We boomed out past the Sheerness Light and headed north, hugging a lee shore in a stiff breeze. The ship drove ahead as steady as a barge, with scarcely a roll or a quiver. But in spite of the smooth and easy way she handled, I couldn't help feeling uneasy. I could sense the black spirit of her brooding somewhere down inside, mocking and taunting us with her bloody memories, and waiting for a new chance. By nightfall, we were running hard in along the Kettering coast, where those rocky headlands break at intervals out of the shelving sandy beaches. The onshore wind held steady in our quarter, and the sun sank down behind the land some 3 miles away. It wasn't quite full dark yet when Charlie sent for me. I came up to where he was standing alone near the wheel.
Good to you, Ned.
Right, Charlie. Wilson said you wanted to see me.
Yes. I did send for you, Ned. Rather steady as she goes, close to the wind.
Aye, sir.
I've been standing here thinking about Maggie, Ned. How she scrambled around over the decks, making friends with everybody, having the time of her life.
Charlie, you've got to stop it.
No, I'm all right. I like to think about her.
It's this ship and all the memories around it. What I was afraid of.
No, no, it's all right. Ned, I want you to take charge of the crew and give an order. Of course, you'll question the order, but you'll carry it out anyway. Do you understand?
What's the order, Charlie?
Have all hands prepare to abandon ship.
What? But why? There's nothing wrong.
Mr. Wilmot, it is not an officer's place to question an order by the captain. Well, there's your turn.
Yes, sir.
You can give the order now, Mr. Wilmot.
Charlie, I can't let you... Very well, Captain.
All hands on deck! Stand by the boats! Prepare to abandon ship!
All right, helmsman. Find your place in the boats. I'll take over the wheel.
Aye, sir.
You don't know what you're doing, Charlie. We're in no danger. There's no reason to abandon ship.
You're always in danger aboard this black-hearted brute. I'll put on the quarter now. You can get the boats in the water when she yields. Hurry on.
Steady! Going on the quarter!
Easy on. All right. Now.
All hands! Lower boat!
You shouldn't have any trouble running ashore to that beach there at the south.
Hey, what about you?
I'll hold her steady until everybody's clear. You better go over the side. Your boat's standing there.
Oh, no, not until you do. I'm staying with you, Charlie.
Don't be a fool, Ned. I'm doing this alone.
No, Charlie, not while I'm here.
Mr. Wilmot, you will abandon ship and take charge of the boats in the water, and that's an order.
Charlie, I can't...
Mr. Wilmot!
Very well, Captain.
That's the spirit, lad. Learn to obey orders and step lively. You'll be a seaman yet. Good luck, Ned.
Thanks, Charlie. Stand by for you in the boat.
Of course, lad. Fine. Bye.
I slipped over the gunwale and dropped down into the boat that trailed alongside on a line from the rail. I'd hardly hit the bottom of the line second. I knew Charlie had cut us loose from the ship. He was alone on an hour. alone in the night sea with a black brute.
Look, sir, look. He's laid it over, away from the wind.
Charlie had put the helm over hard. With a terrible shudder of her dark sails and a smother of white foam from her bows, the great ship heeled about in a sharp turn and then began to drive ahead like some mad thing before the wind. Straight before the wind and straight toward the shore.
Look, sir, the rocks on the headland. She's going to smash herself.
Faster and faster she plunged ahead through the weltering seas. Faster and faster on the back of the gale while the black-hearted spirit of her screamed in the ratlines.
Look, sir, the rocks. What in the name of heaven is she going to do?
And now for one long instant she hung poised at the top of a plunge and then drove smashing downward onto the rocks. Minute, I knew we wouldn't. Because just before I'd left the ship, there by the helm, in the light of the binnacle lamp, I'd seen the thing he was holding, clenched tight in his hard brown fist. It was a tiny platinum ring set with a blue white diamond.
Escape is produced and directed by Norman McDonald, and tonight brought to you The Brute by Joseph Conrad, adapted for radio by Les Crutchfield, featuring Dan O'Herlihy as Ned Wilmot and Eric Rolfe as Charlie Wilmot, with Nina Carlton as Maggie, Jeff Corey as Captain Colchester, Wilms Herbert as German, and Parley Bear as the father. Music is conceived and conducted by Wilbur Hatch. Next week.
You are far into the remote hill country of Afghan. Caught in an ambush by the fierce Papan tribes. Trapped in a hopeless fight from which there seems no escape.
Next week, we escape with Rudyard Kipling's gripping story, The Drums of the Fore and Aft. Good night, then, until the same time next week, when once again we offer you Escape.
Rice Chex and good hot Ralston present Space Patrol! High adventure in the wild, vast reaches of space. Missions of daring in the name of interplanetary justice. Travel into the future with Buzz Corey, Commander-in-Chief of the Space Patrol! In today's transcribed adventure, Buzz and Happy have made a forced landing on a new planet beyond the outer reaches of the solar system. As they cautiously explore the jungle region, they hear the thud of huge feet and a terrifying bellow.
Glenn, look, what is it?
A dinosaur, a prehistoric monster.
It's coming this way.
Get back to the ship, quickly.
It's Jesus. It's after us.
You got to get to the ship before it samples.
Oh, would our ray gun stop it?
There's no time to experiment. Into the ship.
It's almost on top of us.
Close the hatch. Battering the ship. Picking up the crushes like an eggshell.
We'll return in just a moment with today's exciting space patrol adventure, The Menace of Planet X. Hey, did you hear that, space patrollers? That's the Terra City Express train. It's trying to get up speed on ordinary fuel. Not very speedy, was it? But now listen to that same train with super fuel in its tank. Yes, sir, that train's really traveling now because it's supercharged with super fuel. Now, without a good breakfast, gang, you can't go very fast either. But with super fuel in your tank, why, you're supercharged. Here's how Buzz Corey gets up ahead of steam in the morning. He has a good breakfast with Rice Chex or Wheat Chex, the super cereals that help to supercharge you. For taste, they're terrific. For size, perfect, because they both have that modern bite-sized design. So, gang, get off to a quick start in the morning the way Buzz Corey does. Eat a good power breakfast with Rice Chex and Wheat Chex and get supercharged in the red and white checkerboard packages with the mysterious magic space picture on the inside. Rice Chex, Wheat Chex. And now, today's Space Patrol adventure. Rumors of a strange planet beyond the outermost regions of the solar system have reached Commander Corey. Space pilots relate fantastic tales of a weird world, shrouded with mist, a world of glaciers and jungles, where monstrous beasts prowl and do battle. A Space Patrol agent has been sent to the area to check on the stories. But as the hours pass and the agent fails to return, Buzz and Happy blast off from Terra to search for him. Now, in the lonely void, billions of miles beyond the Pluto orbit, the commander and Cadet Happy scan the viewscope screen.
According to the astrogation chart, Commander, we're 12 million GU's beyond the point where Simmons was last heard from.
You mean his last intelligible message, Happy? Well, with that garbled signal 3 hours later.
Yeah, but Major Robertson wasn't sure it came from Simmons. Only about three words came through clearly.
Whether it was from Simmons or not, it's worth investigating if it came from this far beyond the solar system.
Whoever came must have been having hallucinations if they thought they saw a new planet. If there was one out there, we'd have sighted in the viewscope by now.
Well, we can't be sure the message said a new planet had been sighted, have we? All we know is the planet was mentioned.
Well, do you think there could be one way out beyond Pluto?
Well, the Space Patrol has more urgent problems than proving or disproving the existence of a new planet. The last 4 months, more than 200 people have vanished, chiefly from the outer planet, Pluto, Neptune, and Uranus. And so many spaceships have disappeared that people are afraid to make trips out beyond Saturn anymore.
It might be meteors digging up a blasted ship of people without leaving a trace.
Well, that's one thing we don't have to worry about, Happy. This improved repeller ray can detect most of the meteors we'll ever encounter. Happy, there's something in the viewscope.
Simmons ship.
No, it's too big. Turn on the electronic map computer.
Yes.
Now focus on that tiny dot at the edge of the screen. That's it. Too big for a meteor, Happy. It's a planet. A planet nearly the size of Earth.
And these rumors were true.
Yes. If Simmons came out here, he must have seen it. Happy, we're heading our ship for that unknown planet. Planet X.
Planet X. A world so remote from the solar system, it has escaped detection by the most powerful space telescopes. A world at this instant emerging from myth and legend into reality. But there is one man who has known of its existence for some time and has kept it a secret. Over the years, he has built an empire on the strange planet, enslaving the subhuman natives and surrounding himself with criminals and scum of all the planets. He is Commander Corey's archenemy, Prince Baccarati. The towers of his huge, gaudy castle rise into the mist. Mists that swirl about banners emblazoned with Baccarati's dread symbol, a black falcon. Within the castle, the prince, accompanied by Dr. Malengo, a warped scientific genius, opens a heavily barred door and enters a room where a haggard figure slumps against the cold stone wall.
Simmons, get up.
You've been like that for an hour, you have. I think you've got a chance.
I'll get him up. On your feet!
Take your hands off me, you big overdressed clown.
You're like all the rest of the space patrol. Don't know how to act in the presence of your superior.
Superior? Just because you can bully a lot of primitive natives on this backwash planet doesn't mean you're anything more than a big wind.
No lieutenant of the space patrol is going to make a fool out of me. No more time on this stubborn hole. I think he came across my planet by accident.
But they have it. When he doesn't return, Corey will send a search mission after him.
That's true. But we have nothing to fear. We'll never get close to the planet. We can destroy a whole fleet of space patrol ships with our controlled meteors.
And in a few weeks, I'll have my own fleet of spaceships built out to the point where we can attack the United Planet. What will you do with Lieutenant Simmons?
Well, I'll have him taken to the glacier. He'll be put to work in the Endurium mine. He'll be stopped humans.
But perhaps he won't survive more than a week underground. Only the natives can endure the cold up there in the mine.
Reason that is pretty. I only wish I could send Commander Corey out there, too. Come on, Malengo. Let's go out to the tower and check the view.
Returning to the tower of his castle, Prince Baccarati sits before the control panel, watching an enormous view-scope screen that covers an entire wall. Sector by sector, a sensitive instrument scans the black void between Planet X and the solar system. Beside the prince stands Dr. Malingro, smiling proudly at the instrument that he's created.
Your hour of triumph is close at hand. Millions will tremble at your name. And Mercury, Venus, Terra, Mars, the Earth.
Stop your planetary roll call. Look at the screen. Isn't that a spaceship? It is. It's a space patrol ship. It's Commander Corey's ship. See the insignia? Terrified.
I suppose he's sighted the planet.
Of course he has. He's coming right toward us. This is the 10th typing right here, Hope. We can't immediately control.
Ready, Mercury.
Now, both of the beam up toward the meteor battle. Now, you'll see how Prince Baccarati welcomes visitors.
Planet X not only has land, but vegetation, thick vegetation near the equator.
Remember those rumors about jungle growth and giant animals?
Yes, but they're still too far away to confirm that. All we can be sure of now is that there's a desert region, a zone of vegetation, an ice cap at both poles.
The meteor warning system.
Look, there's a swarm of meteors heading right toward our ship.
Those smoke and rockets, where did they come from?
Check their trajectory on the view scope so we'll know how to avoid them.
Yes, but they seem to be swerving out of that meteor belt we checked at 18 degrees high.
You're right, Happy. They're not following us consistent orbit. They're being pulled right toward us.
Commander, we're in a collision course. They're converging on us, a whole flock of them.
Here's where we test our super repeller ray, Hap.
Commander, several meteors are coming head on. Is it working?
Below in a couple of seconds. Watch the view scope. This might explain why we haven't had a reply from Lieutenant Simmons.
Yeah, he didn't have a super repeller ray on his ship.
No, he didn't. But there's a chance we may have landed safely on Planet X. We'll circle the planet and keep calling him.
Rango, what's happening? None of those meteors is taking effect.
I understand it. It's always worked before.
Yes, on our dummy test ship. But this is Commander Corey. If he sends out a report on this planet... Yes, Captain. What is it?
The space patrol lieutenant to escape.
Escape?
We were taking him to a spaceship to transport him to the glacier. So there's a dispute between his guards and then they confuse him escape.
Oh. You'll be punished. Search every inch of the castle ground.
But he's beyond the castle walls, headed south toward the jungle.
In that case, let him go. With those monsters in the jungle, Lieutenant Simmons won't survive more than a few hours. Back to your post, Captain. I have more important things to do.
Yes, Your Highness.
Malengo, what good is your stupid invention? for he's getting so close to our planet, we can't hurl any more meteors at him.
There is still our orbit control. We can neutralize Terry's controls, operate his ship from here. We can crash him in the desert.
Let's do something like that.
Suppose we force him down in the jungle. Lend him safe. Let him think he has a chance for survival. Not knowing about the giant lizards, the prehistoric monsters. We'll see how effective Corey's superior brain is against 100 tons of brute force. We can't do robot control.
Change our vector.
He's fine, he's here, but the ship won't respond.
Let me try. Let's see.
Mm-hmm.
You like the controls of both?
Commander, we're losing altitude.
Adjust your seatbelt, Happy. We're going to crash.
Yes. Hey, what happened?
We just had the luckiest crash landing on water.
You mean the ship landed itself?
Yes. Right in the middle of a jungle.
I'm sure lucky the rockets cut out when they did. It would have been smeared all over Planet X.
Hap, look out the nose for it. Those are birds.
Yeah. Tropical birds. Just like I know.
There must be a beautiful atmosphere on Planet X. And that's a break. I might be here for some time. Let's get out of the ship. Right?
God, it's kind of hot. Like a steam bag. These giant ferns must be 80 feet high. I wonder if those birds are good to eat. I mean, when our ship supplies run out.
We've got emergency rations for 6 weeks. But we'll be able to repair the ship before then.
Hey. Commander, what's that?
I don't know. Sounds like an animal of some kind, a big one.
Hmm? It's coming this way. Smoking rockets, Commander. Look at that. What is it?
A giant dinosaur.
A dinosaur?
Get back to the ship quickly. It's leaving.
Commander, it's after us.
We've got to get into the ship before it tramples us to death.
Would our ray gun stop it?
No time to experiment. Into the ship quickly.
It's almost on top of us. Close the hatch. Commander, it's right outside the door. It's pulling at the ship.
Keep your fingers crossed, Happy. That beast is big enough to crush this ship like an eggshell.
We'll return to Space Patrol in just a moment. Hi, gang. This is Captain Dick Tufeld reporting. Say, how about a briefing on space talk? So you can talk like a regular space patroller, okay? Here we go. Hot rockets. Use it instead of, oh, boy, like that. Hot rockets. Look at that boy pedal that bike. Here's some more space talk, gang. Supercharged. That means wade into a good power breakfast with Rice Chex or Wheat Chex. So you can have the zip and rip of a space patroller. And, gang, that's exactly what Buzz Corey wants you to do. He wants you to supercharge every morning. So just have yourself a hearty breakfast with Rice Chex or Wheat Chex, the super cereals that help to supercharge you. Good? Nope, they're terrific. And remember, they're the cereals with that mysterious magic space picture on the inside of the package. So supercharge, gang, get Chex today. You just can't be without them. And hot rockets, are they ever good? And now back to our space patrol adventure, The Menace of Planet X. With the aid of Dr. Malengro, Baccarati sighted Corey's ship through a mammoth view scope in the tower room of the Prince's Castle on Planet X. Using a robot-controlled beam, Baccarati forced the commander's ship down in the jungle, where Buzz and Happy were attacked by a giant dinosaur, one of the monsters that inhabit the steaming jungle region. Now the enormous creature rips at the hull of the ship with all the force of its 100-ton bulk.
Commander, it's going to tip the ship over.
It's only a matter of time till it batters in the hull.
Oh, if we could only blast off. Maybe if we open the hatch and fire at the dinosaur with our ray gun,
it'd be like hitting an elephant with a fly swatter.
He ran that armored head of his inside the hatch and we'd be finished.
Well, what are we going to do if the rockets won't work? We're stuck.
Hey, wait. Our lighting system still operates. Maybe the super repeller ray will work, too. Brace yourself, Happy. The ship may lunge around a bit.
Yes, sir. It's working.
It's propelling him away from the ship.
Wow, look at him go.
Look at the plants out there. They're bending away from the ship like a strong wind we're blowing.
Yeah, and the birds, they're leaving too.
Uh-huh.
Well, it's lucky you thought of that repeller ray, sir. A few more blows than that dinosaur would have caved our hull in.
Well, that ought to discourage our giant friend for a while.
All the books I've read say the dinosaurs are extinct. I guess this dinosaur can't read.
Yeah.
Happy, look out the viewport to the north. It's like smoke rising up out of the jungle.
Oh, it does. A thin column of blue smoke. I can barely make it out against the mist.
It's too damp here for a fire to start naturally.
Yeah, but how else could it start?
Someone's here. Let's have a look.
You mean go out there, sir? Outside the ship?
Of course. We can't find out anything sitting here.
Oh, yeah, but what about the things? The animals?
We'll keep undercover and move as quietly as possible.
Meantime, several miles to the north, Prince Baccarati watches the giant viewscope screen in the tower room of his castle. Mile after mile of jungle moves across the screen. Then, as the prince makes delicate adjustments, the vegetation becomes transparent, and the dark hull of a grounded spaceship looms up in a tangled growth of tree-high ferns. A smile of triumph is on the evil face of Prince Baccarati. Behind him, a door opens, and Dr. Malengro hurries in.
There's trouble in the north, in the glacial region.
What is it now?
The slaves in the Endurium mines. They have taken over base camp number 2. They have weapons and supplies.
Well, I'll order an attack immediately. They can't revolt against Prince Baccarati.
May I remind your highness that you would lose most of your men in an attempt to regain control of the base camp? The rebels are in a position to fight off all opposition and sabotage the mines.
You're right. Well, then we'll put Plan C into operation immediately.
Plan C? You mean blow up camp number 2?
Of course! Any one camp is expendable, then its destruction will save the other 2. You can handle the whole operation from this tower. The turn of a switch here, a cosmic explosive, and camp number 2 will blast the rebels to bits.
But, Your Highness, some of your men may still be alive in the camp, captives of the rebels.
Well, if they're unable to protect my interests, they are of no use to me. First, we'll broadcast the demand to surrender. If they ignore it, well, they will serve as a lesson to others who try to oppose things.
I think I see flames through the undergrowth, sir. Right up ahead.
Help. Happy to hear that?
Yes, sir. Come on. There's a man coming toward us.
With a space patrol uniform, Hap. Come on.
Commander Corey.
Yes, Lieutenant Simmons. Hold him, Happy. He's about to collapse.
Yes, take it easy, Lieutenant. Here, lean against me.
He's hurt. We'll carry him to the ship.
Help you. All right, Commander. I heard your ship land. I managed to get a fire going.
We saw it. Did you land in the jungle, too?
No, sir. At a castle a few miles to the north.
Castle?
It sounds like I'm out of my head, but I'm not. Commander, Prince Baccarati is here on this planet.
Baccarati?
He's built up an empire here. Rounded up some of his old gang and made the natives work for him.
Natives? On this planet?
Yes. They're very primitive. Never advanced beyond Stone Age culture. Baccarati's forcing them into slave labor. Up north in the glacier region, he's got thousands working in the Endurium mine. That's where he was going to send me when I escaped.
We'll take you to the ship, Lieutenant. When you rest up, you can help us fix the controls and we'll blast off.
Yeah.
Something went wrong. Lucky we landed easy.
That wasn't luck. Baccarati forced it to land, like he did me. He'll never get that ship off the ground.
Unless we get to Baccarati. How far is this castle from here?
It took me 6 hours to get here. Commander, don't go near that castle. Baccarati hates you like poison. You'll end up in the glacier or worse.
If you get out, Lieutenant, we can get in. And we can't stay in the jungle. How'd you escape?
Through a tunnel in the wall, sir. It was used to haul materials from the quarry when the castle was being built.
It's obvious you're too weak to go back with us. We'll leave you in the ship. And Happy and I'll go on to Baccarati's castle.
Wait till I rest up, Commander.
It'll be a day or two before you're fit to travel. You'll be safe in the ship. Just tell us how to find the castle.
nearly at the end of the passage, Captain.
What part of the castle does your funnel lead to?
The sub-cellar. We'll work our way up to the main tower. Have your ray gun ready.
Yes, sir.
All right, come on.
Well, there isn't much light down here.
Come on. Take those stairs at the end of the cellar.
Stand right here, huh? Don't try to turn around, either of you. Don't try to use your weapons, or I'll be forced to use mine. This weapon in your back is a plastic gun.
A plastic gun?
When I pull the trigger, you will be completely encased in a coating of transparent plastic. You couldn't move. Now, will you drop your weapon while you're still able to?
All right. Drop your gun.
Yes, sir.
Very wise. It would be rather awkward to move with plastic statue. Now, step into the elevator. I'll turn you over to Prince Baccarat.
There's no answer from base camp two, Your Highness. But they must be listening.
Might I suggest one more warning?
They had all the warnings they're going to get. Turn on the detonator ray machine. We'll blow our base camp number two.
At once, Your Highness.
Get moving. Line in.
What's the meaning of this interruption?
I found them in sub-cellar 5, Excellency.
Well, well. Commander Corbett, welcome. Now that you're here in my cabin, there's no use wasting power. Cut off the robot control on his ship, Melanie. He's not going back to you.
If you don't turn us loose, it'll only be a matter of time till a squadron of space patrol ships finds your planet and turns this castle into a pile of rubble.
Don't terrify me, Commander. I can cope with any force the space patrol sends against me.
Cadet! You dare to let the pink Baccarati also go?
I'll remember that, Baccarati.
Careful, Commander. My guards can render you helpless if you test again.
I understand you're playing emperor again, Baccarati. You're using slave labor, forcing natives to work for you.
You may not realize it, Commander. But you and the cadet are now slaves yourselves. I need replacements in the Endurium mines up in the Glacier region. Which reminds me, Melango, it's time to destroy the rebels at base camp number two.
Shall I turn on the detonator machine now, Your Highness?
Yes. Commander, you will now see how completely I hold the power of life and death over my subjects. When I press this switch, more than 100 rebels will be blasted to bits. Thousands of mouths can be scattered. Watch closely.
Half, jump the guard.
Get away from that machine, Baccarati. Spider, they're getting away.
Let them go. Right now, we've got to smash this machine.
Get the guard's plastic gun.
I've got it, sir.
Now, let's get Baccarati.
There they are, sir. They just turned a corner.
Down the corner, quick. Baccarati, stop!
Commander, they're climbing out a window.
After them, Happy. There's a ledge out there, Happy. Swarm, we've got to go after them.
Yes, sir.
Easy now, Happy.
Wow, what a drop. There's a river down there.
Press close to the wall. Work down the ledge.
Hey, they're blocked. They can't go any farther.
Baccarati, better give up.
Commander, he's got a plastic gun.
So have we. And Baccarati can't fire without hitting Malengro.
That's right, Corey.
Commander, look at Malengro. Baccarati shot him.
He's covered with plastic.
Smoking rockets, Baccarati pushed him off the ledge. His own partner.
Watch this, Commander.
He's pointing the gun at himself.
Baccarati, don't be a fool. Get to him, Happy, before he falls off the ledge.
Too late, Commander. There he goes. Now he's down into the river. Well, he fell just like statues. Well, I guess that's the end of Prince Baccarati.
Come on, Happy. Let's get off this ledge. We've got to work fast. If we dodge Baccarati's guards, we can get back to our ship before dark.
Lieutenant Simmons is asleep in the aft compartment, sir.
Good. You could do with a little rest yourself, Happy.
Oh, I'm not tired, sir. Commander, you know, I'm glad we got away from Planet X and saved those people in the glacier, but... Well, I'd feel a lot easier if I knew for sure about Baccarati.
Can we cross him off?
That's what we're going to find out on our next visit to Planet X.
An exciting preview of next week's space football adventure in just a moment. Hey, what's going on, young man? What do you mean, putt-putt-putt-putt-putt-putt?
I'm playing like I'm driving a surface car on Mars.
Well, it sounds to me like you've got nothing but ordinary fuel in that tank of yours. You're just a putt-putt. You know what your car needs? Super fuel. Here, I'll put some in. There now.
Gosh, my surface car is supercharged now. See you later.
Yes, sir, space patrollers, for supercharging, it takes super fuel. And that holds true for you, too. Ordinary fuel for breakfast, you're just a putt-putt. Super fuel for breakfast, you're supercharged. That's why Buzz Corey has Rice Chex, the super cereal for breakfast. Rice Chex, crisp, golden shredded rice biscuits in that modern bite-sized design. The cereal that brings you a mysterious magic space picture inside of every package. Try it today. Delicious bite-sized Rice Chex, the super cereal that helps to supercharge you. And now, a preview of next week's exciting space patrol adventure. Buzz and Happy have made another visit to the mysterious Planet X. They had just landed in a robot ship, hoping to thwart an attempt to obtain space patrol secrets. As two men in work clothes approach the ship, Buzz and Happy wait with ray guns drawn.
Keep behind the bulkhead until we find out whether they're friendly or not.
Yes, sir.
Quiet now. I'll be out of here.
Use your gas gun, Mangrove.
Commander, I can't see.
You fell right into my trap, boy. This is your last trip to Planet X.
Be sure to join us next week for the thrilling story, The Trap on Planet X, when Wheat Chex, Rice Chex, and Good Hot Ralston again present Space Patrol. Special bulletin for boys and girls in Cleveland, Ohio, and Syracuse, New York. Buzz Corey's own space battle cruiser, the Ralston Rocket, will be in your area next week. Don't miss it. The Ralston Rocket. Space Patrol, created by Mike Moser, starring Ed Kemmerer as Commander Corey and Lynn Osborne as Cadet Happy, was written by Lou Houston, produced and directed by Larry Robertson, executive producer Mike Devery. Other players were Bela Kovach, Norman Jolly, Ken Mayer, and Stephen Robertson. Dick Tufeld speaking. Now, don't forget to tune in next Saturday and every Saturday when Wheat Chex, Rice Chex, and Good Hunt Wilson again present Space Patrol. Be sure to see another exciting Space Patrol program on your local ABC television station. Consult your local newspaper for time and channel. This program is broadcast to our armed forces overseas through the worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. Space Patrol came to you transcribed from Hollywood. This is...